Seven Dials presents Messi, written by Guillem Balague, read by Peter Kenny. Foreword by Alejandro Sabella. I was appointed national team manager after the Copa America in Argentina. The national side had been eliminated despite not losing a game. They drew twice and beat Costa Rica in the group phase, then drew with Uruguay in the quarterfinals before losing on penalties. When a team with players of this quality and strength plays in a tournament of that nature, we all find it frustrating if they don't end up as champions, even when, as happened in this case, they do not lose a single game. It is normal for the players to have a heightened sense of expectation at the beginning of a new era with a new coach. We were coming at a low ebb, having failed to progress further in the Copa America. I felt there were conflicting feelings, despite the disappointment. We were sufficiently motivated to move forward with renewed optimism. The first time I spoke to Leo was in Barcelona. It was in 2011, soon after my appointment. I set out to meet all the players who were playing for sides in Europe. My first stop was Portugal, followed by Barcelona. I didn't know Leo personally, but I wanted to speak to him and to Javier Mascherano, whom I had met before and who was the captain, to suggest that Leo should wear the armband of the national side. The main purpose of my trip was to introduce myself and to get to know the players, especially those I didn't know, such as Leo. But the question of the team captaincy was important to me. I considered it essential for everyone to know Leo was the leader and that he would lead in his own natural manner. It was vital that he should be recognized as such by the players. The three of us met, and afterwards I went to Italy, leaving them to discuss it among themselves and to give me their answer. I think it was Javier who rang me to say yes, Leo would be the captain. After that meeting, we met again in India to play one of the national team's first games, a friendly against Venezuela, and later against Nigeria in Bangladesh. But if one match symbolized the new era, it was surely the one against Colombia in the South American qualifiers for the Brazil World Cup 2014. We went through a difficult moment in Barranquilla, where, fortunately, the lads were able to turn around a match played in suffocating heat. We were losing 1-0 after a goal from Dolan Pabon that went in off Mascherano. Fortunately, Messi equalised before Agüero made it 2-1 near the end. As I often say in football, there are defining games, matches that provide the lift you need, the push required to get you going along this new road. I think that game was perhaps the beginning, because after that, we started to build a close-knit group, and when a group is close, they get results, are happy playing together, and achieve so much more. It is the perfect way, the only way, to overcome your weakness. I am asked if that match defined not only the national team, but Leo himself, since it was from that match onwards that he began to be perceived differently in Argentina. It was certainly the start of a change of perception, but there was another one as important. On the 29th of February, the day we played Switzerland away. That was such a wonderful performance, the day Leo scored a hat-trick. It was his first hat-trick for his country. He had done it for Barcelona countless times, but that was his first one in the blue and white of Argentina. Later in the same year, he scored three more goals against Brazil. But yes, that game against Colombia was, from both a footballing and coaching point of view, the confidence boost we needed. What I can say is that Leo is a very calm person. He possesses natural leadership as a result of the enormous level of ability he has attained, and what is more, his leadership is accepted by everyone. I like to give all footballers freedom, and that includes Leo. They live with enough pressure as it is, and I prefer to let them move around freely. The captaincy brings with it greater responsibility. But Leo knows this and has accepted it, and it is helping him to mature and grow. And that is also good for his teammates. His team talks and private discussions remain in-house, but I can say that there is undoubtedly a generally happier vibe within the group, a sense of calm that goes beyond work and the job. There is a relaxed and happy atmosphere. It is crucial. And there you have the mixture you need for Messi to show what he is capable of. Leo has to feel comfortable, and first and foremost, he needs to be free. He needs the flexibility to know that he can do whatever is necessary on the pitch at any given moment. In truth, I only discuss the bare minimum with him, merely what is necessary. I don't want to put any extra pressure on him, because the footballers already know the importance of the games and of their individual contributions to the side. When you talk about Messi, you need to talk about his development, because, as they say, the hard bit isn't about getting there, it's about staying there. So winning 4 consecutive Ballon d'Or is a sign of great progress. Obviously, just winning 1 Ballon d'Or is hard enough, but to win 4 on the trot is proof positive of just how far he has evolved as a player. During the past few years, he has grown to maturity and has developed extraordinary skills that have served to make him increasingly better as a player. It is difficult to maintain, let alone exceed that level of excellence, but somehow he has achieved it. I am sure that taking over the captaincy of Argentina has served him well in that process. It is necessary to get the confidence of everybody around you to grow as a person and as a player. The year 2012 was a great one for Leo with the national side, a result of the maturity he has gained as he has grown older. When they say that a footballer has reached his peak, what are you supposed to do? Leave him to his own devices? It is important, for my part, that education and direction continue. No player is ever too good to receive constructive advice and direction. To illustrate his immense attributes as a player, you need only look at the opening match of the 2013-14 league campaign against Levante, that Barcelona won 7-0. When Leo goes in to steal the ball, he does it with conviction and determination until he succeeds in his objective, as he demonstrated in that game. He stole it, and it became the third goal. I have even seen him score headers as if he were a natural. What he is, in fact, is one of those extraordinary players who only gets better, as difficult as that is. Barcelona chose to play him in the centre, a ploy we copied in the national side, simply because it worked so well for them. Leo gets more of the ball in that area, and the more he gets the ball, the better it is for everyone else. As he is mature, confident, intelligent, he cannot be marginalised on the sides. And with Higuain and Herrero opening up the spaces for him, and with Di Maria operating on the wing, Leo can decide from his position in the centre where to take the game. It is clear that with these players, Leo has become more powerful, and vice versa. So that everything works out well, I ask all of the players to make that little extra effort to win the ball back, to help those at the back to sacrifice themselves more. And Leo has to defend wherever he may be in the play and within the possibilities opened up to him. No one asks him to perform miracles, but the main thing about Leo and others in the side is what they do with the ball. This is where Leo's work bears fruit. Normally, the best players in the world play in the world's best sides, and they are the ones who have the longest seasons and play the most games. Naturally, this sets them apart. What is important is that they get to that stage at their peak at the World Cup. Some achieve it, some do not. Now, we have a team that is playing well, that gives an appearance of solidity and looks like a team. That is what they showed in a friendly against Italy on the 14th of August 2013. But the fact of the matter is that any team in which Messi plays is never going to be the same team without him. We have to try to get rid of the notion that we cannot achieve victory without Messi. That obviously affects morale, and on that day, despite Leo's absence, we played a great game. There is no doubt, though. Yes, we can survive without him, but he is irreplaceable. And no, there is no contradiction in what I am saying. Messi is our symbol, our standard bearer, an extraordinary player who plays in an extraordinary team. Maybe the greatest player of all time. Introduction. Where's Leo? That was the question on everyone's lips in Leo's classroom at the Juan Mantovani Middle School. His school was situated in the district of Las Heras, in the south of the Argentinian city of Rosario, close to his home. Leo had missed a week of school, and apart from brief illnesses, he rarely did that. His desk stood empty, and at playtime, when someone got a ball out, the game seemed even more confusing. There is no football pitch at the Juan Mantovani, and there are always too many kids for the small, cramped playground. It did not encourage spacious, expansive games, and with Leo absent, even less so. It had been some days since he had been seen. It was September, 3 months before the end of the academic year, which in Argentina begins in December. Exams were set around that time, and Leo couldn't be present. Someone asked on his behalf if he could do his exams on another day, or if he could be given work while he was away. No, sorry. Has Leo come in today? His teammates at Rosario Club Newell's Old Boys, NOB, where he played in the lower ranks, were asking the same question. He'd missed a number of training sessions at the Malvinas Training Academy, and he wasn't around for the match at the weekend either. Hepatitis, said someone at the club. He's got hepatitis. Ah, that'll be it. Nobody really knew what it was, but it sounded terrible. Something that if you caught it meant you certainly couldn't play football. Yes, the maestro has hepatitis. That'll be it. The maestro. Messi had at other times also been El Piki, Titch, at school, but was the maestro to his adolescent peers, as others among them were Clark Kent, the Galician, the Greyhound, the Korean, because of his haircut. No one had Christian names and surnames in Argentinian football, and that's how the official squad list was written. Name, date of birth, height, and nickname. The Mouse, the Bitumen, the Short One. Where has Leo gone? Adrian Correa looked after this diverse group, Leo's first 11-a-side trainer, but he too knew nothing of the boy's whereabouts. Strange to disappear in September. And more than strange, a problem. Winning without Leo would be much harder. Someone telephoned Quique Dominguez, his previous coach at Newell. No idea, I don't know where he is. But he assumed that something was happening. He was always a reliable boy, but when he had gone for a trial at River Plate just over a year earlier, he hadn't said anything then either. Had River finally taken him on? Someone said he had hepatitis. The Messi family got a phone call some days before. Come now, bring the boy. They had waited so long for this day, and now, suddenly, everything was happening in a rush. They had to prepare to go to Europe. Newell's were not told. Not a single coach, technical director or player in the club knew what was going on. Neither Leo nor his dad Jorge, always looking after the kid's career, wanted to tell anybody. It was not difficult to keep their own counsel. They are both discreet, equally reserved, cast in the same mould. With a sense of premonition, the Rosario newspaper La Capital devoted an entire page to the youngster. The first one. It was the 3rd of September, 2000. A very special little leper, read the headline. Leper, a sobriquet shared by all his teammates at the club that had once, in the 1920s, played a charity match to raise money for a leper clinic. And on one side, a smiling Leo, head tilted, wearing an NOB shirt. He will always be a leper, a passionate supporter of Newell's, the club that was everything to him in his youth, where he had just won the title in his team's age group, a source of pride to him. And with his quiet voice, it was difficult to get the boy to smile for the camera. He shared with the journalist interviewing him some of his dreams. He wanted to be a PE teacher and to play in the first division naturally, and get into the Argentine national youth team. It was a long way away, but yes, of course, to get into the national side, a dream. He liked chicken. His favourite book, the Bible. The first thing that came into his head. He isn't one for reading books. If he hadn't been a footballer, what other sport would he have chosen? Do I have to answer that? I don't know, handball maybe. But yes, he saw himself as a PE teacher. It was the only class at school that he enjoyed. He could be a PE teacher. It was the newspaper supplement devoted to the Rojinegros, the red and blacks, the colour of the NOB shirt. The text began, Lionel Messi is a player from the 10th division and is the enganche, player in the hole, playmaker of the team. As a boy, not only is he one of the finest prospects from the Leprosa Academy, He also has a tremendous future ahead of him, because despite his size, he manages to go past one, two players, dribble, score, but above all, he enjoys himself on the ball. Rametea, to dribble, enganche. The words, the concepts, all very Argentinian. Leo was not the cover star of the edition 97 of that supplement. That was left to Claudio Paris of the first team, who had decided a few days earlier to stay with the club. A black and white photocopy of the article made its way across the Atlantic. Jorge and his son Leo, and the friend who was travelling with them to Ezeiza Airport, discussed the article as they made their way from Rosario to Buenos Aires. The journey of 3 and a bit hours seemed longer than that as they travelled along a straight, boring road, featuring little else but valleys and traffic signs. Leo gazed out of the window from the back seat. It was the 17th of September 2000, a Sunday. From Ezeiza, with the knowledge only of those closest to them and the school principal, they left for Barcelona. A 24-hour journey lay ahead of them. The first journey was good, because it was a completely new experience for me. I'd never flown before, never undertaken such a long journey, and I enjoyed it all, until the aeroplane started to move about a bit. Leo Messi in Revista Barça. Memories can play tricks on you. In truth, the flight experienced a lot of turbulence. When the first meal was served, Leo didn't eat, sleeping instead, stretched out over three seats in his short trousers with his skinny little legs. He felt nauseous. His stomach was churning. He slept fitfully and felt sick. Years later, and with great frequency, he would feel the same nausea before running onto the pitch and would sometimes ask himself if that feeling of sickness he had experienced on that flight really had been caused only by turbulence. The party arrived in Barcelona at midday on Monday the 18th of September, 7 months after taping a home video that demonstrated in some eyes that Messi was the new Maradona, and in others, more familiar, closer to him, that his was a natural talent that could help him make it as a footballer if everything went according to plan. Someone bought Messi a kilo of oranges and some tennis balls. They asked him to practice with them for a week. 7 days later, they recorded the VHS tape, which showed him making 113 touches with an orange. With the tennis ball, it was easier. 140 jugaditos, as they say in Argentina. 140 kick-ups. There was a table tennis ball lying around. Give it to Leo. They gave it to him. 29 touches in a row. You try it. See if you can reach 3. This Leo had an advantage over you. He spent all day, every day, with the ball. Between games, during the game, at home, in the schoolyard, every blessed day. 8 years later, MasterCard released an advertisement using some of those same images. You can see it on YouTube. And since February, when the video was recorded, the Messi family would ask themselves, when are we going? Where are we going? Are we going? It became the daily topic, one discussed both with uncertainty and a hint of excitement. The video, along with others taken at the Malvinas pitch, showing Leo in his Newell shirt performing his slalom-like runs and dribbles, landed on the desk of Josep Maria Minguella, a well-known player's agent with a lot of influence at Barcelona, and a member of the Catalan club as well. He wasn't too sure at first. The age and distant location of the youngster put doubts in his mind, and he would not be the only one. In the end, though, months later, convinced partly by the spectacular technical skills Leo showed on the tape, partly by the insistence of colleagues who had faith in the boy's future, he decided to put all his weight behind the project and persuaded Barcelona to give him a trial, just before Real Madrid made their own initial move to try to sign him. From his office, Minguella called Argentina to tell the Messis to get their things together and come to Barcelona as soon as they could. Bring the boy. Leo was about to fly for the first time, and to cross the Atlantic for the first time. Out of the aeroplane and into a humid Barcelona towards the end of summer, stepped a 13-year-old Argentinian boy with talented feet and a suitcase. With the dream of succeeding against new rivals and with new companions, at a big club, far, far away from home. Those who saw him for the first time, so small, thought that Barcelona had made a terrible mistake. All this effort for this? How was someone so small ever going to become a good footballer? I started to follow Barcelona at the time of Ronaldo, and shortly afterwards came the opportunity to come here. At that time, to tell you the truth, I was very excited and very keen to come here to see what everything was like, because I was seeing it from a long way away. But when I got here, I didn't know how difficult it was going to be. Leo in Revista Barça. It wasn't Lionel Messi who arrived in Barcelona that day. It was just an excited kid. Dave Sudbury's song, The King of Rome, says that when you live in a dump like the West End of Derby, you can't live out your dreams. I know that, says someone who wants to challenge destiny. A man can crawl around or he can learn to fly. And when you live round here, the ground seems awful near. In Rosario, in 2000, it was harder than ever to learn how to fly. Newell's rejected the chance of helping the Messi family, who needed a great deal of money to pay for the hormone injections that Leo so badly needed to help him grow. Had they paid for them, the young Leo would never have left Argentina. Nobody knew of anyone who had crossed the Atlantic so young in search of their footballing fortune. 13-year-olds certainly didn't leave Argentina, nor was it usual for European clubs to sign foreign players of such a tender age. No one had ever had such an opportunity so early. Back at Las Heras, nobody had the faintest idea what was going on. Leo has hepatitis. Yes, that'll be it. In Barcelona, Minguella had been told that if Barcelona were prepared to meet the cost of the expensive growth hormone treatment and his father got a job, thus fulfilling the necessary regulations for the transfer of the youngster, Leo would come to them. There were calls to Real Madrid and Atletico de Madrid, but nothing concrete emerged. In any case, if Barca show interest, better with Barca, was the rationale of all those who had worked to seal the transfer. Josep Maria Minguella. Most of us involved in this were not used to dealing with such young players. For example, I came into contact with Pep Guardiola, or he with me, when he, Pep, was 20 years old. So I became his agent at the time he was coming into the first team. All the machinery that is now in place for players of 12, 13 and 14 years old was not there at the time. So when our contacts in Argentina spoke to us about a youngster who was different, my first reaction was, right, what are we going to do with a boy of this age? I doubted it at first, but in the end, they insisted so much, I started to take it seriously. I received a video, the one where he picks the ball up practically from his own goal mouth and dribbles it past about 1,000 people and scores, and yes, he struck me as something different. A few months later, I spoke with the president, Juan Gaspard, and Anton Pereira, sporting director, and Charlie Reshak, technical director and advisor to the president. Charlie Reshak. Playing tennis one day, Minguella told me he knew of a boy who was a phenomenon, a bit similar to Maradona, but I've heard that many times. And then later he told me he was in Argentina. I thought, ah, a youngster about 18 or 19 years old. Then Minguella told me he was 13 years old. I said, are you mad or what? Do you think I'm going to put myself there? No way, no way. Joaquim Rife. I was the director of the academy at Barcelona, and I eventually got offered the boy. Charlie Reshak was the technical director of Barcelona and obviously centred more on the first team. What happened was that Charlie Reshak is a good friend of Josep Maria Minguella, who was the one who introduced the lad to FC Barcelona, so he listened to what he had to say about the kid. Charlie Reshak. There's a process here. If they say to me that there's a kid, for example, in Zaragoza, who is a phenomenon, I ask, who is he? Where does he play? And where do I have to go to watch him? Then I send two or three people to study him, and then if one of them says yes and the other no, I go myself and have the casting vote. Later, you have to try to find him a place in the team, and a number of other things. Another possibility is that an ex-Barcelona player, let's say Rivaldo, says to me, listen, there's a 12 or 13-year-old boy in Brazil who is a fantastic footballer. I will take notice immediately because when it's someone like Rivaldo who is telling you this, you take it into account. If someone else tells me, I will suspend judgment on it for the time being. But even if Rivaldo says go and see him, I will say no. Let's do it the other way around. If he's so small and he's coming from so far away, send him to me here. We'll keep him for 15 days so the coaches at the academy can study him at their leisure. And if in the first few days he is a bit nervous, he'll get over it. Imagine if we go all the way to Argentina or wherever and the lad becomes ill or can't play or whatever. He has to be very good for us to skip the rules and regulations. Josep Maria Mengele. The parents and the boy were going to leave Argentina anyway, come what may. If they had been unable to stay in Barcelona, they would have tried other clubs. I told Charlie that he was following a course of treatment that the clubs in his country were not paying for, and that Barcelona would have to make themselves responsible for this treatment. Charlie Reshak. So, Mingueya, who I trust very much, said to me, "There's a bloke, they tell me, is a phenomenon. So how do we do it?" And so, since Mingueya had received the video that displayed Leo's keepy-uppy and dribbling skills, the months passed by that way. "Oh, I don't know. Maybe he is too far. He is too young." That was the confusing message that reached the family from Barcelona. Months of uncertainty for the Messi family, who asked what had happened to that tape, the interest and the contacts. What was going to happen to Leo? What should they tell him? Charlie Reshak. So I said to Mingueya that I was not prepared to travel so far to see a boy of 12. Had he been 18 or 20? Anyway, that's when I told him that by Easter or Christmas or whenever, we had to find a date for the boy to come over with his parents and stay here for 15 days. Rife. I told Reshak that I had organized a game so he could watch the boy. Gaspard, Pereira, Rife, Mingueya, Reshak. Barcelona royalty to deal with a 13-year-old boy coming from Argentina. Heavyweights. And the significance of the presence of these fathers to the young boy did not go unnoticed by the academy trainers, who would be responsible for judging and training him for the next two crucial weeks. Rodolfo Boré. I remember that one day in the office, someone, I can't remember who, gave me two black and white double-sided photocopies, an article from an Argentinian newspaper that talked about Messi, and they told me that this boy was coming over for a trial. I have been looking for these photocopies. I'm sure that they're at my parents' home. I should find them. And I remember it because it was the first time I heard the word gambetta, dribbling, and the word enganche, which is a very Argentinian word used to describe the player who plays just behind the striker. They told me that the youngster was going to be in my group because he was born in 1987. I have always said that the reason I trained Messi first is only because I was responsible for the training of that under-14 side. I'm sure you have heard that there are 10,000 trainers who claimed to be the first to coach him. No? Waiting for them at Prat Airport in Barcelona was Juan Mateo from Engelia's office, who took them to the north of Barcelona, where the agent was based. In the lift, the Messis crossed paths with Chiqui Beguiristain, the future sporting director of Barcelona, and someone close to Mingueya. "We're from Argentina," one of them dared to say, and Chiqui, ruffling Leo's hair, said, "This boy must be good. He is small." And after talking with the Catalan agent, Jorge and Leo made their way to the Hotel Plaza. It was not Barcelona who paid the expenses for this trip. They never did. Mingueya, who knew the owner of the hotel situated in the Plaza España, arranged for the Messis to stay in room 546 of the hotel, with views. From the window, they could see the halls of the Barcelona Exhibition Centre, and away in the distance, the National Palace and the Montjuic Fountain, that lit up at night in a blaze of colour to the sound of synchronised music. Closer were the towers that flanked the Avenida Reina Maria Cristina, erected for the Universal Exhibition of 1929. And in the foreground, the fountain of the Plaza España, a classical allegory of the country with sculptures that symbolize the rivers that flow into the three seas that wash the shores of the Iberian Peninsula. Leo Messi left his suitcases in the room. The young footballer was feeling a little better, but still weak after the bumpy flight. Even so, Rife had let Jorge know that he wanted to see Leo train. Today, at 6 o'clock, he had to go. Rodolfo Boré would be his first trainer at FC Barcelona. Rodo, now director of the Liverpool FC Academy, was for the 2000-2001 season in charge of the Infantiles, a side that would later become historic. Cesc Fabregas, Gerard Piqué, Marc Pedraza, Marc Valiente, Víctor Vázquez, Tony Calvo, Cito Riera, Rafael Blázquez. One of the best junior sides that Barcelona have ever had, and now they were adding to it with a player who'd arrived with something of a reputation of his own. That Monday afternoon, those in charge of the academy, Quimet Rife, Quique Costas, Juan Manuel Asensi, the coaches, Rodolfo Boré, Xavi Llorens, and Albert Benages, met on pitches 2 and 3 next to the mini stadium, one with grass and the other with artificial turf, to follow the progress of the group and especially the new boy. Charlie Reshack was not present, having gone to Australia to watch the games at the Sydney Olympic football tournament that was packed with well-known young players, among them Tamudo, Xavi, Puyol, Zamorano, Suazo, Mbuma, Lauren and Itu. But in truth, the matter of a young Argentinian boy did not require his presence. His prime responsibility lay with making decisions about the first team, not the academy. If, down in that cauldron of talented youth, they could all agree, then the boy recommended by Mingiria would be signed. If not, he wouldn't. Charlie had arranged the trial. For the time being, he didn't have to do much else. Messi felt calm as he made his way to his first day of training, still a bit nauseous after the exertions of the journey. But he was there because this is what he had wanted and what he had fantasized about. He had a week at most. He had to go back to school to demonstrate what he could do with the ball. That was the easy part. Imagine never having seen the Camp Nou or the mini stadium. Leo hadn't. Arriving at the pitches adjacent to the mini, a Camp Nou in miniature, the flea hesitated before entering the dressing rooms. He felt embarrassed walking in by himself. His shyness... No, he is not shy. He is reserved. Is extreme. He started to get changed outside the locker room and ended up doing so inside, away from the rest of the group, in a corner with no one nearby, standing up, tense. Imagine never having seen Lionel Messi, like that group of players of the same age, or those coaches who had only briefly heard of him. "He's so small," said the youngsters. Rodo was in the dressing room. "Sit down, young man," he said to Leo. The kid hadn't said hello when he entered, or the noise he made when he came in did not sound like a greeting. It didn't seem like a friendly hello. For Cesc, for Pique, who were also getting changed, the Argentinian was just another kid coming from a trial with Barcelona. They were rarely foreigners, but occasionally one or two were. A few new boys every month. Rodo approached the group while Leo was changing in the corner. "Be careful with him. He's very small. Don't break him." Pique. In that first week, Leo was isolated, very isolated. If there was a group of people talking or having a laugh, he was on the bench, right at the end, very reluctant, quiet, introverted. Cesc. "So many new players came that we didn't attach any importance to it, but I remember his first day perfectly well." The young players were giving him mocking looks. Messi was bandaging his ankles. Pique. "He was very short. He hardly said a word, and no one could have imagined what was going to happen." He measured 1 meter and 48 centimeters. 4 foot 10 and a quarter inches. Cesc. "He had longish hair and spoke soft, quite Argentinian, so you could hardly hear him. In fact, he hardly spoke at all. He was a noodle. We thought, this bloke is a waste of space." That was the general consensus. One of Barre's assistants was worried. He saw how he was putting on bandages and asked him if he was injured. "No, no, it's an Argentinian custom, to prevent sprains." Leo said nothing. The jokes kept coming from the group of 12 and 13-year-old boys. "The bloke's a midget." Messi ran out onto the pitch next to Pique, who looked twice his size. Leo came up to his waist. Jorge was in the stands and heard what was being said. "He's very small. He's too small." The group began to warm up, always with the ball. Firstly, it was all about controlling the ball. One touch, two, three, 10, 11, 12. "He's not dropping the ball," said one of the spectators. 20, 21. Cesc. "When he started to touch the ball, we saw that he was different from the rest of the boys who came for trials." Gradually, Rodolfo Borre set up some one-on-ones and shots on goal, and when Leo got it, problems. Cesc. "First, he made me look like a complete fool and stuck it in. And as a young player, I had a special talent in defensive one-against-one situations. Now I'd lost it. I used to steal the ball with ease. I don't know how I did it. Anyway, he made me look so stupid you wouldn't believe it. Okay, the first time you're not expecting it. You're a bit too relaxed. But he did it to me again and again." Messi was dazzling with his dribbling, his finishing, his consistency. The youngsters entertained themselves watching the new boy's moves. he had won the group's respect. From that moment on, anyone who called him the midget did so with admiration, even affection. From the stands, you could hear, "Oh, wow, this is something else." Leo travelled to the mini and the pitches adjacent to it by underground from the Plaza España. Four stops on the green line to Les Corts. As there wasn't training every day, with his father and one of Jorge's or Mengele's colleagues, they passed the time strolling beside the port with an occasional visit to a museum, although he didn't spend a lot of time in them. They didn't make a great impression on the kid. The tourist bus took them to the Sagrada Familia, to the port, the zoo. He would tour the old city. Tuesday was a free day. Monday, Wednesday and Thursday, he was part of the group and joined them in the drills on the clay court. Friday, they would concentrate more on tactics, and he took a less active role. The weekend was also free for him. Naturally, he couldn't play official games yet. It was still sunny in September, the heat less fierce than in August, and better for walking at any time of the day. So the Argentinian group would travel to Sitges, spending mornings on the beach, and took in a football match. His first visit to the Camp Nou. The first Saturday of his stay, he saw Barcelona play there. The opponents, Racing Santander. Patrick Kluivert scored a brace, Marc Overmars the third. The men of Llorenç Serra Ferrer, not the most popular of Barcelona coaches, won 3-1. Leo took a photo from the stands. The stadium was enormous, but the crowd made little noise. They wanted to go to the Barcelona-Milan group stage Champions League match on 26th of September. They couldn't get tickets. The Italians won 2-0. The rest of the time, Leo was never far away from a ball. They played head tennis in the hotel bedroom, and he would take the ball out onto the terrace to weave past imaginary opponents, to play keepy-uppy, to caress it. Television filled the remaining gaps. Lionel did not say much. He wasn't timid so much as introverted, charming to any adults who approached him, monosyllabic to his teammates in those first days. Off the pitch, there was a lot of killing time waiting for the return from Sydney of Charlie Reshek, because no one would give the nod to confirm his signing. On the pitch, he was something else. Next to his new teammates, he didn't seem like that timid boy who the day before was quietly eating a pizza, or a hamburger, or a plate of pasta, or just walking, lost in his own thoughts. When he was alone in his room, or just before going to sleep, by the light of his bedside lamp, he would take out a thick pen syringe and inject whatever leg needed injecting that day. And the same routine the following day. Touches of the ball, a visit to the city, pizza, training in the afternoon, an injection. Leo, do what you know. Get the ball, don't pass to anyone, and head for goal. Jorge Messi's advice was about exploiting the very talents that had brought him to Barcelona, but also a natural reaction to Boré's insistence as a Barcelona trainer that they should play one- and two-touch football. We have to come with our own game, show you as you are. If he knew one thing, it was how to dribble. While the rest of the group passed the ball around and obediently kept their space, Messi offered something else. And so it went on, day after day. He trained with the Junior A group, and at the end of training would play a game with the Junior B side. His father would watch him from the stands or leaning on the fence that separated the two pitches. One day, he scored 5 goals and hit the post twice. He played for himself, but did so with such conviction, with such talent, that it wasn't worth trying to correct him. One touch, Leo, shouted Rodo. But he was really reminding the rest of the group. One or at the most 2 touches. It didn't matter what he was told. Leo played as he had always done, with little touches, with speed, with flow, dribbling right and left. A ball player more than a footballer. And there is a huge difference. Another day, he scored 6 goals. Jorge wasn't sure if the pressure was good or bad for his son. At some point, a friend of Mingueya suggested to him that he should reward Leo's goals with presents. If there was a rucksack that he liked, some football boots, he would be given them in exchange for goals, let's say 5. His father wasn't sure it was going to work and preferred not to interfere. But the challenge motivated Leo. He scored 4, but one shot crashed against the woodwork and appeared to go in. No, it didn't go in, he was told. Leo went crazy. It did go in. There was a complete set of sportswear at stake. A heated discussion followed. He eventually got the present. After the first week, the former Barcelona player Migueli who was working for the youth ranks of the club, came round and asked, "Who's the boy who's come from Argentina for a trial?" Leo, who was training, was pointed out to him. "The little fella there, the one in the middle of the pitch." He looked at him. He had a ball on top of his left foot. He was awaiting instructions. "I don't have to see him play football. Just by the way he's standing, you can see he is a good footballer." Just like that, nothing more. He'd hit the nail on the head. It was late, around 8 o'clock in the evening. Migueli continued watching the session. "What are these people doing that they haven't signed him yet? This boy is the closest thing I have seen to Maradona. And he should know. Migueli, a former centre-back, played with Diego at Barcelona." But the days were passing and no one was saying anything to Jorge, nor to Leo. They were waiting for a decision from Rife and the return of Reshak, who was still away. But they had to get back to Argentina. They had already lost too many school days. Jorge insisted that they could not be away for more than a week. It was now the 8th day. Something wasn't right. There is one thing in the Messi mythology that has been misinterpreted. It said that some of the Barcelona coaches were not convinced of his talent, uncertain about signing him, would say one thing to his face and another behind his back. Their names are mentioned sotto voce because some of them are still at the club. Others have developed successful careers away from the camp now that might be damaged if this was to be revealed. Reshak's interpretation of the situation further confuses the issue. There was your typical guy who would say, "Well, he's too small, the sort of bloke that should play indoor football, a table football player, the usual stuff." But in truth, the trial was going well, more than well. It was also decisive. Just 5 minutes at one of the training sessions was enough to show his talent. From a coaching point of view, Charlie Reshak's appearance at pitch 2 or 3 to watch Messi was hardly necessary either. He had no need to make the casting vote. But in the end, Reshak had to be convened and the Messis had to delay their return to Argentina. The first team director should not have been involved in such decisions, but no one, it seemed, was prepared to take responsibility for the possible failure, or even in the best-case scenario, the success, of signing up a 13-year-old Argentinian boy. How on earth do you explain the doubts? To begin with, the involvement of such club heavyweights, Reshak, in spirit at least, Mingueya, Anton Pereira, Rife, in the potential transfer of a child footballer, was proof that this was something special, something unusual. Leo was protected from above, and with so many important names on the case, something was definitely going on. Or at least, that's how it was seen by those looking on from the sidelines. The matter became the talk of the town during those weeks and created great expectations. Rodolfo Boré's colleagues spent whatever time they could taking a look at him. The debate was not so much about his talent, but how to harness his individuality to the club's own established and collective game plan. But this heavyweight interest was not the oddest thing. In 2000, the very idea of bringing over a youngster from Argentina seemed like lunacy. It simply wasn't done. Leo's talents were obvious for all to see. An anonymous source at the club who saw him during those 2 weeks described Leo as las hostias en patinette, which means the dog's bollocks, but translates more or less as something that moves like lightning. He did then, that source continues, the same as he does now, but in miniature. It would be an injustice to history to suggest that the reason they might not have wanted him was because he was too small. There was something else. These days, it is considered quite normal to bring a youngster of whatever age to a club from anywhere in the world, and the battles to sign children as young as 8 years old are well documented. But in 2000, they were breaking new ground. 5 years earlier, the signing of an infantile, 12 to 13 years old, from Mataró, Granollers, San Pedro, towns less than an hour from Barcelona, was considered to be bringing them a long way. The cadetes, 14 to 15 years old, came from all over Spain. And now they were talking about taking on a young Argentinian lad who had arrived aged just 13. Hold on a minute. Many studies have been carried out on the subject, and at that time the general idea was that no matter how good a player might be at that age, no one could guarantee that he would make it into the first team, or even end up as a professional footballer. To take him away from his family, his country, his friends, all of that, to put him in a situation where there are no guarantees, Of course, now he has become the best player in the world, and it has become a wonderful story, but... So says another witness to that most unusual of arrivals. It would not be the youth football coaches who would decide his future, but they talked among themselves about the possible dangers of the situation. The club had been reticent even about signing players from distant parts of Spain, taking them from their home environment, their school. The normal thing, the logical thing, it was said, was that Leo should be treated the same. Oriol Tort, one of the most renowned scouts, the leader and ideologist of the Barcelona Academy, has always claimed that the preferred age for a player to join La Masia is 15 or 16. That's how things were in 2000. So was it, as legend has it, lack of awareness among the coaches, or a sensible reluctance on their part because they knew the effect that uprooting the boy would have on his family? For example, Andres Iniesta. As a youngster, 12 years old in 1996, he took part in the national tournament of Brunette with teams from the Spanish First Division, La Liga. As always happens in tournaments of importance, the club sent various scouts. The best players on this occasion were, first, Iniesta from Albacete, and second, Jorge Troitero from Mérida. At that time, both La Liga clubs. There was no prize for second place. But the debate centred around which one of the two was better. Barcelona took note, spoke with Iniesta's family, worked out the contractual details with the player before deciding that he should remain at home and that they would monitor his progress from a distance. The idea was to bring him to La Masia 2 or 3 years later when he had reached the age of cadete. Troitero's father was not prepared to take defeat sitting down, so he set out by car from Mérida in Extremadura in western Spain, across the country to the offices of Barcelona. His son was going to be a footballer, no question about it. He knew that the club had had positive reports about the boy, and the idea of Barcelona appealed to the family. So, either they signed him now, or he would go to Madrid or to Valencia, or wherever. Barcelona had told the family about the effect on the boy's schooling, the upheaval, the relocating, but his father persisted. It was his son, and he was going to get him into a big club. Barcelona, despite their initial objections, yielded to the pressure because the youngster, an extremely skillful left winger, had a lot of talent, something that he would soon show at the lower levels. But there was no boy of that age at La Masia. In fact, there was only one under the age of 16. So what did Barcelona do? They called Iniesta from La Mancha to come to Barcelona to keep Troitero company so that he would not be lonely. Jorge Troitero was eventually thrown out of La Masia for indiscipline. Iniesta, who spent a lot of the time crying in his room in the farmhouse in which the players from outside Barcelona lived, would years later score the goal that earned Spain its first World Cup. There are fears, doubts, promises, and today also a methodology in Barcelona's famous academy. But still, there is no guarantee of success. Someone asked Leo after 8 days of training if he still thought it was a good idea to sign for Barcelona. That person was Rodo Boré. Leo said yes. He liked the training methods. In Rosario, it was all much more physical, and here most of the work was done with a ball, which pleased him. He was enjoying it, and he could see how massive the club was, and the challenge. He wanted to stay. 10 days after the Messi's arrived at Barcelona, there was little more to see of the city, no more to know about him as a footballer. Everything was done. He had taken nearly 2 weeks off school, and that had never been part of the plan. It was clear that any club would have wanted Leo, but this was a unique experience for Barcelona, and no one wanted to take the risk. They had to wait for Charlie. Jorge was ready to return home. "Stay one more day. Reshak will be back on Monday," he was told. The president's advisor finally arrived from Sydney and met up with Rife. There were a number of issues on the table, among them the matter of the Argentinian boy. "Play him in an older group, 2 years older. I want to see how it unfolds when he plays with the bigger boys," said Reshak. Charlie Reshak. "I got involved so as to give my casting vote, because if those under me had said, let's sign him, then I wouldn't have come down." The final trial was set to take place on the 2nd of October, at 6 in the evening. Instead of the clay surface where he had played most of the time, this would take place on pitch 3, the artificial surface located behind the bowling alley, facing the mini-stadium. The moment had come. There was no going back. The following day, Leo and Jorge were to return to Argentina. Leo, all 1 meter, 48 centimeters of him, was to face youngsters 2 years older than him. Michele came to see him, and Rife, of course, and Quique Costas, Xavi Llorens, Albert Benages, and also Rodolfo Boré, who had had him in his team for the last 10 days. They sat on the substitutes bench. The game started, and Charlie Reshak still hadn't arrived. He was coming late after a lunch. Recently back from Australia, he was between time zones. 2 minutes later, Charlie climbs up the steps leading to the pitch. Charlie Reshak. I did the usual, walked about a bit and stopped when I saw him get the ball. Reshak comes through the door, passes the corner flag and goes behind the goal. Charlie Reshak. He was easy to spot because he was tiny, quite a sight, no? Messi gets the ball in the centre of the pitch and starts to dribble towards whoever stands in his way. Jorge Messi. Carlos, Charlie, came in and Leo made a move. Charlie Reshak. Like I said, I went behind the goal and kept walking. Leo dribbles past two, rounds the goalkeeper, scores. Jorge Messi. Great play. Goal. It was their only goal of a game that Leo's team ended up losing 2-1. Reshak gets to the substitutes bench, not the first, but the second, where all the coaches have gathered. Charlie Reshak. It took me 7 or 8 minutes to complete the lap. I went to sit down on the bench and... 10 minutes after he had arrived, Charlie Reshak left pitch number 3. He had sat down for a couple of minutes on the youth coach's bench, turned around and gone out again the way he had come in. All that waiting, and he hardly saw a thing. Jorge Messi thought Reshak had not given Leo the attention he deserved after the journey, the days of waiting. Had Charlie noticed the couple of things that Messi did? Jorge was asking himself. Surely that was enough to keep him at the club. Hopefully. At the end of the game, Leo said nothing. Always quiet. He just listened. Part 1. In Rosario. Chapter 1. Pass it, Leo. But he never did. Every Sunday. Last one is a rotten egg. Without fail, Leo would arrive at his grandmother Celia's house and there, on a small concrete patch in front of the house, would play rondos, toros, or in English, piggy in the middle, with his brothers Rodrigo and Matias, though in those days it wasn't called rondos. Or they would play foot tennis. Then his cousins would arrive, Maxi and Emmanuel. A third cousin, Bruno, would also be born to Claudio and Marcella, Leo's aunt and uncle, some years later. Two rocks served as goalposts, the first to score 6 goals. So the game began. Leo's grandmother and her daughters, Celia and Marcella, busied themselves in the kitchen preparing pasta with a rich sauce. The husbands, Jorge and Claudio, and his grandfather Antonio, chatted animatedly on the sofa in the small narrow dining room, or on the doorstep, ears and eyes ever alert for the children at play. Look at that touch. Notice how Emmanuel dribbles with the ball. Leo, as small as he is, and how difficult it is to get the ball off him. Good, Maxi, good, shouted Jorge, who had played in the lower ranks of Newell's Old Boys until called up for military service. Time to eat. The children drifted in, hungry but reluctant to leave the game. Hands had to be washed before everyone sat around the table of that humble 2-bedroom house that no one ever wanted to leave, and that served as a meeting point for hundreds of Sundays for brothers-in-law Claudio and Jorge, sisters Celia and Marcella, and for the cousins who always wanted to play football. Sometimes the sofa doubled as a bed for one of the grandchildren, whichever one insisted on staying over on that particular day. They adored their grandmother Celia, and it wasn't just because of the delicious pasta or the rice, every scrap of which was finished off. Celia was one of those grandmothers who could never say no to her grandchildren. Food was eaten in a rush, everything was delicious, but with a ball tucked under an arm, the 5 youngsters, still savouring the taste of dulce de leche, milk candy, headed off to the square in the Bajada part of town. And it was there that they would finish what they had started, or start another game of 1st to 6, once more giving it their all. 4 hours non-stop, sometimes more. There were never uneven games. Sometimes the bigger boys, Rodrigo, born in 1980, Maxi in 1984, and Matias in 1982, would challenge the smaller boys. Leo, born in 1987, and Emmanuel in 1988, who was a good goalkeeper. The kicks they received were shared evenly, far more rough and tumble than in the younger football matches. Much more. Leo and Emmanuel were at the receiving end from the older, frustrated ones, especially Leo. "Matthias, careful, man," Jorge would shout. And Leo would run around like a headless chicken after the ball, and then when he got it, he would refuse to let it go. With veins bulging, his face redder than a tomato, that is how his uncle Claudio remembers him. And watch out if he lost. He would start to cry and throw a tantrum, hitting out at anyone who dared to try to console him. He had to carry on until he won. Always ending badly, always fighting. Even if we won, my brother would annoy me because he knew I would get angry. It always ended badly with me crying and furious. So said Leo to the Argentinian magazine El Gráfico. Often the clashes were between neighbourhoods. The Sunday matches they played in the little square next to Grandma's house were open to anyone, and the Messi Cucitini team never lost. Matthias explains, "At first, they didn't want to play against us because Leo was so small, and so was Emmanuel, and they ended up congratulating him. Leo was 9 years old, and he was playing against 18 and 19-year-old kids, and they couldn't stop him." Is it any wonder that at least a couple of footballers emerged from this rich mix of talent? Rodrigo was signed by the Newell's younger section at the age of 11, having previously played, as had all the Messis, for Grandoli. He was a central attacker with a great ability to score, fast and skillful. He was selected for his age group for Rosario in intercity meetings. Leo told the story of his brother's early football retirement in Corriere della Sera. Yes, he was very good. Sadly, he had a car accident where he fractured his tibia and fibula, and in those days, if something like that happened to you, that was the end of your career. That, and perhaps he lacked the tenacity needed to become a professional. His passion, he discovered, lay in the kitchen. He wanted to be a chef. Matthias was a defender in Newell's lower ranks for a year before deciding not to carry on. But he returned to football years later, and his last club was Club Atletico Empalme Central, who competed in the Rosario Regional League, and where he played until he was 27 years old. Maximiliano, 1.65 meters tall, and the eldest of Marcella and Claudio's three sons, scores regularly for the Brazilian side Esporte Clube Vitória in the Serie A Brazilian Championship, having been in Argentina with San Lorenzo de Almagro, Paraguay, Mexico, and also the Brazilian club Flamengo. In his first training session with his first Paraguayan team, Libertad, he fractured his skull, but he is stubborn and came back to football. The day after the premature birth of his daughter, Valentina, who spent her first few days in an incubator, he scored for Vla. The same evening, Messi hit a hat-trick for Barcelona against Valencia and dedicated the three goals to Valen. Emmanuel, from Rosario, like all of them, inseparable from Leo as a child and with whom he shared time at Grandoli, started as a goalkeeper and spent a year at Newell's before making the step to Europe. Now, he is a left-sided midfielder. He arrived in Germany in 2008 to play in the reserves of the TSV 1860 Munich side, and the following year made it into the first team. He was also at Girona in the Spanish second division. Now, 1.77 meters tall, he plays for Club Olimpia in the Paraguayan first division. One day, he would like to play for the Newell's, as Argentinians refer to Newell's old boys, with Maxi and Leo. Bruno was born in 1996 and missed out on the early street contests, although he enjoyed many other street matches with other youngsters, and was one of the great prospects from the Rosario-based club, Renato Cesarini, that produced Fernando Redondo and Santi Solari, the son of one of the club's founders. He looks and plays very much like Leo, the way he runs, his touch on the ball, even the way he celebrates his goals. But you have to be careful with comparisons. Today, on his Twitter and Facebook accounts, he writes, "Life is not the same without football," February 2012. He left it all behind him, but now he is trying once again to climb aboard the high-speed train that is football. Leo left for Barcelona, aged just 13, and so the meals he shared with his cousins became less frequent, and the football matches naturally became a thing of the past. The boys were growing up. Life was separating them. But some of the child remained in all of them, as it does in all of us. Celia, Leo's grandmother, died when he was 10. A river, the meandering Paraná, the Monumento Nacional a la Bandera, the National Flag Memorial, two great clubs, and its people, above all, its people. This, for the visitor, is Rosario. What sort of place is Rosario? Rosario is 300 kilometers from the capital, Buenos Aires, about 3 hours via a road that runs arrow straight, cutting through an enormous valley with little between the two cities. Far from the madding crowd, seemingly isolated, a proud little city. The people are not from the province of Santa Fe, they claim. They are Rosarinos. And their local derby is lepers versus scoundrels. Newell's Old Boys versus Rosario Central. Half of the city's inhabitants plus one against the other half plus one. The most passionate game of all, according to anyone you ask, even though many prefer to forget that sometimes passions become confused and turn to violence. Leo is a leproso, leper. Newell's are referred to as such because a century ago, both they and Rosario Central were invited to take part in a charity match in aid of a leprosy clinic. Newell's accepted, Rosario Central did not. Since that day, the NOB rivals have been called canallas, scoundrels. Arriving from Buenos Aires via the motorway, you have to take the exit to the ring road, a large C flanked on the right by an area comprising tin shacks boasting the colours of Rosario Central that tell you you are entering the city of the canallas. This is soon confirmed, as is the very opposite. No, this is the city of the leprosos, you can read on other walls, daubed in the red and black of Newell's Old Boys. The statistics and the graffiti disagree with each other. These tin shacks, home to so many families on the outskirts of Rosario, have windows with views over the motorway. The areas around here are poor, with dirt floors, where people ride around on motorcycles without crash helmets. Old motorcycles, but not vintage ones. Later, the poverty disappears to be replaced by factories and other large buildings. Every driver seems to be admiring the scenery or taking note of something, because none of them seem to be paying attention to road signs or markings. Either that, or perhaps, as some Argentinians say, traffic signs are put up merely to hinder your progress. Before you come to the end of the motorway, you begin to see the outline of an attractive city, with skyscrapers of varying size. The road becomes tree-lined, and all of a sudden you espy a gigantic modern factory, complete with those labyrinthine tubes on the outside that add a strange industrial beauty to the landscape. The plant is fed by the Paraná River, and this is the first sight of this crucial river artery, bringing with it its fertile alluvial soil, an age-old source of wealth. And after the trees and the factory, then you enter the city through a new park before two-story houses begin to dot the landscape on both sides. The ring road turns into a great avenue flanked by the outline of a city, tall, stately, old. It was from Rosario, the gateway to the Pampas, a village masquerading as a city, that Che Guevara, the singer Fito Páez, the cartoonist and writer Roberto El Negro Fontana Rosa, and football greats Marcelo Bielsa and Cesar Luis Menotti emerged to challenge the establishment, and where thousands upon thousands of European immigrants landed. It was also here that other iconic Argentinian symbols were born. Here, where the blue and white flag of Argentina was hoisted for the first time, created in 1812 to distinguish them from the Spanish troops they were fighting. On the way to the centre of town is Independence Park, described by the journalist Eduardo Van der Cuy as where the city starts to define its own style and personality. From the park starts the elegant Boulevard Orono, which looks like a Parisian postcard. Buried in this mass of mature trees and natural foliage is Newell's Stadium. The streets become narrow, and at the crossroads, of which there are many, you're never sure who has right of way. It seems to be the first person to get there. The white walls have turned grey, and the cafes have high ceilings, large picture windows, and small tables. Inside the cafes, many of the men pass the time looking at the pretty girls, while the ladies, including the older ones among them, enjoy admiring the physiques of the young guys, all of whom look fit enough to be footballers. Everyone says that the most beautiful women in Argentina come from Rosario. There's that irresistible mix of Serbian and Italian genes that combine to create blonde-haired beauties with olive skins and light-coloured eyes. The good food contributes to the overall healthy and lustrous complexions of the inhabitants. Rosario is one of the most productive agricultural regions in the country, surrounded by fields producing cereals and soya oil. The young grow fit and strong. There are not many football shirts in evidence, neither those of Central or Newell's or of the national side, although there are football pitches everywhere, sometimes every two blocks. There are 5 or 6 leagues, and many of the footballers play in more than one. Finish one game, pick up your motorbike, and then go and play another in a different league. In Rosario, anyone who isn't a footballer is an organiser, trainer, referee or whatever, women included. It's different from other cities because of its unique passion for football, says Gerardo Tata Martino, former Newell's manager and now at Barcelona. The area near the city is a conveyor belt of players, a football factory that produces the talents that are central to the objective of Rosario's footballing dreams. They are what we describe around here as well-fed youngsters with an enormous passion for football. That's why the Rosario Academy is so important and has created such stars as Valdano, Batistuta, and an interminable list in which Lionel Messi is the icing on the cake. He could also have named Mario Kempes, Abel Baldo, Roberto Sensini, Mauricio Pochettino, and many more. Indeed, 10 of the regular players in Alejandro Sabella's squad for the qualifying stages of the 2014 World Cup are from Rosario, including Javier Mascherano, Ever Baniga, Angel Di Maria, Ezequiel Lavezzi, Maxi Rodriguez, Ignacio Scocco, Ezequiel Garay, and of course, Leo. It was in Rosario that the Church of Maradona was formed, half in jest, one would imagine, devoted to Diego, whom they consider to be the greatest player in history, and in whose honour they have a quasi-religious ceremony every year on the 30th of October, his birthday, that parodies the Catholic tradition of the country. Maradona had a brief spell at Newell's in 1993. Leo went to his debut in the black and red shirt. Football is life in Rosario, and life is football. And to that end, the spirit of the city is appropriately reflected in one goal in particular, according to the Guinness Book of Records, the most celebrated one in history. It happened on the 19th of December 1971 in a match played in suffocating heat in Buenos Aires between Newell's and Central. It was the semi-finals of the national championship and the only time the two clubs had faced each other in the country's capital. Neither side was able to find the opposition's net in a match that was taken up with the battle to win control. Then, 13 minutes from time, there was a foul close to the Newell's penalty area. Aldo Pedro Poi, the Rosario Central striker, made his way into the area. As he did so, he called out to one of the cameramen. What was it? A premonition? A prediction? Call it what you will. Get your cameras ready, this one's going in. And so it happened. Poi, jostling with his marker before getting away from him, soaring into the air with his body arched, his arms extended. Goal! A flying header. So what if the ball had brushed the stomach of central defender Di Rienzo, wrong-footing the goalkeeper? Goal! A definitive one, too. The eternal rival had been knocked out in the semi-finals. Central went on to win the final, the first title the Canaias had won in their history, but not to celebrate it as Boy's diving header. The ambitiously titled Organización Canalla for Latin America has for the past 3 decades met every 19th of December on the pitch at the Central Stadium. On this day, someone crosses the ball and Poi reenacts his diving header. Lately, however, the problem, as Poi himself says, is not so much making the dive, but getting up again after it. This is Rosario. This is football. Messi did not rise out of nothing. Neither did Alfredo Di Stefano or Diego Armando Maradona. Perhaps it's not about an Argentinian gene, but one thing for certain is that the three were born in a country where every day football takes you to the bigger glory, the fame, the money, or the smaller one, the recognition of all your neighbours. But as Martino says in the magazine Panenka, this excellent raw material and passion that is found in the streets of Rosario has to be channeled in one way or another. To this end, the work of Jorge Grifa has been vital, a man who, after retiring as player, was quite clear about what he wanted. He had no ambitions to become the manager of a team in the Primera, but rather the creator of players, and he never betrayed his original ideas. From the mid-70s and for 20 years thereafter, he left an indelible mark on Newell's Old Boys. Later, he went on to become youth coach at Boca, but always with the same idea, to be a forger of players. Grifa has a great talent in this area and a clinical eye for spotting talent, even to the extent of enlisting assistants. Marcelo Bielsa was one of his assistants in the glory years. He crossed the country from end to end, not just Rosario and the surrounding areas, searching, always searching for hidden gems. Bielsa travelled thousands of kilometres in his tiny Fiat 147 in this tireless mission that bore so much fruit for the Leprosos. His hard work was rewarded. Newell's were champions in 1988 with José Yudica, and in 1991 and 1992 with Marcelo Bielsa as first-team coaches. Grifa also spotted the talent of Messi at a crucial moment in what had been, till then, a brief footballing career. You breathe football everywhere in Rosario, but curiously, the air doesn't smell of Messi. There are hardly any photos or pictures, not even advertisements depicting Leo. Everybody has a story about the flea, but the Santa Farina city does not seem to want to gloat. It's almost as if it is considered vulgar to have his face posted everywhere, or perhaps they have just decided to respect his low profile. But for Leo, Rosario is everything. When you ask him what his favourite memories are, he is in no doubt. My home, my neighbourhood, where I was born. The Messis lived for decades in a small house on the Calle La Vajija, located in a suburb some 4 kilometres southeast of the centre of Rosario, known by some as La Bajada or Las Heras. To others, it remains nameless. It is just home. It is a typical low-rise community where front doors are left ajar. Cumbia music, chatter and laughter emanate from within. Kids play in the streets. Traffic is rare. Time seems to stand still in Bajada. In this sleepy working-class area, at number 525 on the narrow Calle Estado de Israel, is the house Jorge Messi built with his own hands. His father, Eusebio, was a builder by profession, and Jorge quickly learned to do everything. The two Messis used the weekends to lay brick upon brick on a 300-square-metre plot of land bought by the family. It was at that time single-storey, a similar size to all the other houses in the street, with a backyard to play in. One wall faced the house of Cynthia Arellano, who was the same age as Leo and his best friend. Today, the road surface has been improved, as has the street lighting and the drains. The house has a second floor, a fence, the only one in the street, and a security camera, but almost always remains closed. This is where Jorge Messi, Celia Cucitini, and their 4 children lived in the early years. It was, remembers Leo, in Corriere della Sera. Small, a kitchen, living room, 2 bedrooms. In one bedroom, my mom and dad slept, and in the other, me and my brothers. This, then, was Leo's street, just 200 metres from an uneven piece of fenced-off land covered with rough, wild grass where football was played. Next to it, the kiosk where Matias worked when Leo was already in Barcelona is still there, right next to the house where Matias lived and that he later gave to a relative. Go to the top of the street and you will see Grandoli. Grandmother Celia lived around here, and a little further up were the cousins. And close by are the paternal grandparents, Rosa Maria and Eusebio Messi Baro, who at 86 and years after retiring, still gets up every morning to open the humble bakery he installed in a room in the house that they have lived in for the past 50 years. Everything starts and finishes in that neighbourhood. The family unit is the fertile ground on which the Messis and the Cucitinis were raised. Leo is devoted to his parents, his brother, his cousins, his uncles, to his mother, above all to his mother. He has a tattoo of her face on his back. He did it without saying anything to anyone. He came around one day and showed us. We almost fainted with the shock. We didn't have a clue that he was going to do this, but it's his body and there's nothing we can say to him, his father said, in C.K. Rodriguez's book, Educados para Ganar, Educated to Win, in which the parents of the best-known graduates from FC Barcelona's La Masia give their side of the story. From here also came Leo's best friends, whom he still sees whenever time permits. For Messi, Rosario, La Bajada, or whatever you want to call it, represents his childhood. A man's true homeland, as the poet Rilke would say. The place where he wants to return, where he returns constantly. The place he has never left. The place he has recreated for himself in Barcelona to make everything easier. That's why he returns home to his family whenever he can. It is to Rosario that he escapes when there is a sufficiently long break at any time in the summer or at Christmas. You don't see him in the neighbourhood so much now, not since he bought a larger property on the outskirts of the city. But at other times, he has been seen cycling there. Sometimes he travels around neighbouring regions, as in the summer of 2013, when he was seen in a supermarket pushing a trolley full of muffins, wine, and breadsticks. He was spending the day in Gualeguaychú, in the southeast of Entre Ríos, a sleepy town where, despite the cap he was wearing, he was easily recognized and asked to pose for photos. He's had to get used to being photographed in the street. He never has any protection. He even has a long-term girlfriend from his hometown. Antonello Rocuzzo is, like Leo, from Rosario, and is the cousin of his best friend, Lucas Scalia, who plays for Deportivo Cali in Colombia. He has known her since she was five, and today she is the mother of his son, Thiago. But things could have worked out differently. Antonella and Leo stopped seeing each other for a while, when he was just another boy trying to attract her attention, and she was a cute little girl who wasn't interested. Leo went to Barcelona, and on a trip back home from the holidays, the romance blossomed. Make a note of this. Rocuzzo, Scalia. Leo is a Messi, and his mother's maiden name is Cucitini. The family are grandchildren and great-grandchildren of Italian immigrants who came to Rosario from Ecanati and Ancona in the Marche region of Italy. Lionel also has Spanish blood. Rosario attracted Europeans, mainly the Spanish and Italians, who made up half the population in the first decades as the city grew. One of Leo's great-grandmothers, Rosa Mateo Ijese, came from Blancafort de Trago de Noguera, an area in the Pyrenees near Lleida, and emigrated to Argentina as a child. Crossing the Atlantic, she met a man from Belcaire de Urgel, José Pérez Sole. When you leave home, new relationships are strong and long-lasting. They are the life raft of the immigrant. This is the real new world, the foundation of a new life. Rosa and José supported each other throughout the transition to a new beginning in a foreign land. They eventually married in Argentina and had three children, one of whom was Rosa Maria, wife of Eusebio Messi, the parents of Jorge Messi. Recently, Corriere della Sera carried out an interesting exercise with Leo, reminding him of the Messi family roots. They were from Recanati, like Giacomo Leopardi. Who was he? A great poet. Sempre caro mi fu quest'ermo colle, e questa siepe, che de tanta parte, dell'ultimo orizzonte il guardo esclude. I've never heard of him, I'm sorry. Maybe you've heard of the Virgin of Loreto. It's close. No, I'm sorry. Where is it? La Marche, central Italy. Have you never been curious to go and see where your grandparents came from? No. I think my father knows the place. He has been there and has seen our relatives. Maybe one day I'll go as well. Have you at least seen the Hotel of Immigrants in Buenos Aires? It's where most of the Italians who first arrived in the country based themselves. No, I don't know it. Then the journalist showed him some old black-and-white photographs of those who'd gone in search of their fortune on the Pampas. Stern-looking women with shawls and long black skirts, skinny barefoot children, enormous casseroles for food, the men in dark jackets, white shirts and felt hats, the eyes gazing into the void of the unknown, the kind of look that ought to be described in the lyrics of a melancholy song. Leo looked at them with some curiosity, but little else. For Leo, everything starts and finishes in Rosario. The Messi Perez family settled in Las Heras. Close by lived the Cucitini Oliveira parents of Celia, who was also of Italian descent. In the neighborhood, the spark of love between Jorge and Celia was struck, and they wasted little time. Aged just 15 and 13, they realized what was happening and didn't fight it. 5 years later, when Jorge returned from his military service, they married. Soon, they were planning to go and live in Australia. Would an Australian Leo have been a footballer or a footballing star? We'll return to that later. But as it turned out, the Messis preferred to carry on living in their parents' neighborhood. Celia worked for years in a workshop producing magnetic coils for industrial use, and, like everyone else in the migrant community, Jorge was prepared to do any job that would provide an income, whether it be making screws in a metal workshop from 6 a.m, or as a door-to-door collector of monthly medical insurance premiums. But he knew that to better himself, to guarantee a future for his family, he had to work hard. He didn't make it as a footballer after 4 years at the Newell's Old Boys Academy, so he started to study in the evening, from 5 until 9, after he had finished work, to become a chemical engineer. It took him 8 years to finish the course. He was 22 years old and had his priorities in order. His efforts reaped their reward. Jorge joined Hacendar, one of the main pressed steel production plants in Argentina, in 1980. the year his first son, Rodrigo, was born. To get to the factory in Via Constitucion, some 50 kilometers from Rosario, he had to catch a work bus. Competition was encouraged, and Jorge rose swiftly in the company, finally becoming manager. His salary made keeping a family of three no hardship, or rather four. Matias arrived in 1982. My father, says the second Messi Cucitini, was a worker. We never wanted for anything, but he was always, as now, humble. We always worked for a better life. My old man, my old mum, and all of the brothers were able to study in the best schools. We wanted for nothing. Theirs was a house in which food was always good and never wasted. Always a good reference point. Leo corroborates this, telling Corriere della Sera, we eat Argentine or Italian cooking, spaghetti, ravioli, chorizo, sausages. My passion is for beef milanesca. My mother makes it like nobody else. Exceptional. Normal or with sauce, tomato and cheese on top. Ours was a modest family, but we weren't poor. Honestly, we wanted for nothing. There is a common misconception about the origin of most Argentinian footballers. The overwhelming majority come from that section that would be classified as middle class, that in Europe would be known as working class, but not lower class or poor. The same as the Messi's, in fact. There are not many examples of footballers who have emerged from poverty to become successes in Argentinian football. At least, that is, not since Diego Maradona was born in the slums of Fiorito to the south of Buenos Aires. The truth is that the poor rarely get to trial for football clubs, sometimes because of lack of contacts, or sometimes of resources that prevent them from going to training, buying kit, being properly fed, or getting into a football school with all its corresponding costs. Without this last step, hardly any of them become professionals. And those from the lower classes that do manage to get into a club are not accustomed to having continuity and perseverance in their lives because of the absence of a family structure, and because they live in villages and communities where discipline and sacrifice are not encouraged, where drugs are a distraction. Few professional footballers, therefore, emerge from poverty. There are some, like René Hausmann, World Cup 1978, Maradona, even though he never went hungry, Carlos Tevez, perhaps Ezequiel Lavezzi, or Chippy Berijo, a player with Carlos Bianchi's Boca of 2000, who these days dedicates himself to giving back to football what it gave to him, taking kids from the street, feeding them and training them at Bajo Flores, but very few others. Argentinian footballers are, in the main, middle class, a section of society that experienced great difficulties in the last decade of the 20th century, when inflation caused the peso to lose value daily. Argentina stopped growing. The future looked bleak. The face of Argentina in the 80s was changing. The Falklands War of 1982, the military reclamation of the islands occupied by Great Britain, was intended to distract attention from the continual and progressive failure of the economic policy of the military junta, then running the country. Social tension was palpable, and inflation unstoppable. Argentinians were dying, and their hopes with them. But the military failure united indignation that was finally converted into the definitive action that would finally overthrow the regime. In December 1983, democracy returned. 4 years later, the country was on the brink of civil war following the rise of a group of young army officers known as the Carapintadas, painted faces, under the leadership of Colonel Aldo Rico. The army could not take any more humiliation and resolved to put an end to judicial processes against the military regime that sought to prosecute them for violations against human rights. Even though Argentinians took to the streets to defend democracy, and despite national strikes across the country, including in Rosario, President Raúl Alfonsín bowed to pressure and finally passed the due obedience law that exempted military personnel below the rank of colonel from responsibility for crimes such as forced disappearance, illegal detention, torture and murder. The Argentinian government was covering their recent past with a very thick coat of paint. Up to 15 explosive devices caused chaos in various cities between 1984 and 1985, including Via Constitución, close to the factory where Jorge Messi was working. This was the soundtrack of outraged Argentinians unwilling to accept the obligation to forget the dark past or to submit to military blackmail. In the following months, the streets of cities and towns throughout the country were filled with protesters demanding higher salaries and a fairer economic policy. On the 24th of June, 1987, in the middle of an economic and political crisis, and almost a year to the day since Maradona had lifted the World Cup in Mexico, and on the 52nd anniversary of the death of composer and actor Carlos Gardel, Lionel Andres Messi was born, after a scare. Doctors feared that they might have to induce the birth with forceps because they diagnosed a fetal distress. Jorge feared the consequences for the baby, who was ultimately born naturally, even though he was little redder than usual and had one bent ear. No, it won't be forever. Wait and see. Tomorrow it'll be all right, the parents were told by gynecologist Norberto Odetto. The third son of the 27-year-old Celia Cucitini and 29-year-old Jorge came into the world at the Italian clinic in Rosario, weighing in at 3.6 kilograms and measuring 47 centimeters. Leo. Lionel. That's what the parents decided to name the baby. But it was not Lionel Richie who inspired the name, despite popular legend, even though the singer, much admired in the Messi household, was then at the height of his fame. Jorge made his way to the register office, having agreed with Celia that Lionel was to be the infant's name. Sounded nice, but not quite right, he thought. On arrival, he asked for a list of other names he could use. He didn't want his child to be called Leo. The list included Lionel, which was the name in English. He liked that, so Lionel would be entered in the records. There was a row at home, because, in the name of God, Jorge, that was not what was decided. It was a fleeting row, but a row nonetheless. As it was, fate was to get its own back on Jorge, for today the whole world knows his son as Leo. Fortunately for his father, in Argentina, that becomes Leo. Leo started to walk at 9 months, and was often found chasing a ball that his brothers had left around in the house. Just days after getting himself up on 2 feet for the first time, the child dared to go out into the street. The front door was often left open. Cars seldom passed. That, remember, was the type of neighborhood they lived in. As he tottered about, a bike went past and knocked him over. Leo cried, naturally, but it seemed that he hadn't been hurt. As he slept, the boy made little noises. His arm was swollen. Indeed, more than that. A cracked ulna of the left forearm was the hospital's diagnosis. The first sign of a weak body, and also of an extraordinary resistance to pain. For his first birthday, he received his first NOB shirt. The whole family are leprosos. Except for the most rebellious one, Matias. He was central, of course. The new Messi Cucitini was already playing with the ball with his brothers, a child more fascinated by watching football than he was cartoons, and who on his third birthday received as a present a ball with a pattern of red diamonds. "Look after him," shouted his mother when he went out, aged just 4, for a kickabout with the older boys. My mother let me go out to play football, but as I was younger than the others, she was always there on the sidelines to see if I started to cry. This influenced me a lot, Leo told the Colombian magazine Soho. The following will be familiar to many, especially those who grew up wanting to be footballers, and more especially by those who actually made it. In bed, Leo did not sleep well without a ball, if he couldn't feel it close by, normally at his feet. And he was in despair when they took it off him when he went to bed. For him, a football was like bread at mealtimes, an ever-present. When his mother sent Leo to do some shopping, the ball went with him. If not, then he didn't go. And if he didn't have one handy, he made do with rolled-up bags or football stockings, whatever he could find. Leo left the house with a ball, lived with the ball, and slept with the ball. He only wanted the ball, remembered Rodrigo Messi in a video played during the gala presentation of the 2012 Ballon d'Or. Jorge insists that he used to do other things with his friends. He went out on his bike, played marbles or PlayStation with his neighbours, watched television. He was a normal boy, his dad repeats. But as Jorge also admitted in the German magazine Kicker, since I can remember, always close to a ball. Jorge, who himself showed promise as a central midfielder in the lower ranks of NOB, admitted to Ramiro Martin in his book Messi, Un genio en la escuela del fútbol, Messi, a genius in the school of football, that one day Leo surprised everyone. It was during a rondo that we were doing with all my sons in the street. My son Rodrigo had the ball at his feet, and Leo was in the middle chasing it. In a flash, he threw himself at the feet of his brother and took it off him. We all looked at each other, surprised. No one had told him how to do this. It came naturally. From that moment, all eyes were on the boy and his talent. The plaudits fell on the child, who felt happy at their happiness, happy with himself. And like all youngsters, he wanted more, more of the ball, which meant more attention, more enjoyment. In El Gráfico, Jorge remembers that at 4 years of age, we realized that he was different. He did little plays and the ball slept on the point of his boot. We couldn't believe it. A bit older, he played with his two brothers, who had 7 and 5 years on him, and he used to dance around them. It's a gift, something he was born with. That small child, that quiet boy who had spent his time either at home or at his aunt Marcela's, who only liked football, as remembers his friend and neighbour, Cynthia Ariano, soon began to attract attention in the narrow Cayo Estado de Israel. Cynthia's house, she is a month and a half older than Leo, was next to the Messi's house in La Bajada. They shared the same first school years, and he sat next to her in the classroom, or behind her if there was an exam. With Cynthia, El Piki, Titch, spoke more. That's what they called him. One day a boy shouted out, "Come here, Titch," and the name stuck, remembers his best friend, today a qualified psychologist and teacher of children with learning difficulties. Cynthia was the one that would go to his house and persuade him to go to school, the one who would sometimes explain to others what he was trying to say, the one who would pass him the crib sheets, the little notes, either on a ruler or a rubber, the one who wrote on the small pieces of paper that she passed to Leo during his exams, the one who brought him his afternoon snacks, the one who told him, "You're going to be sorry if you don't learn things now," and the one who heard him reply, "Yes, I'll regret it, but I can't do it." The one who explained his absence if he skipped class one day, which occasionally happened. The one who told the little white lie that she was his cousin. She was the one who learned of the fact that he was injecting himself with hormones when, on one trip at the end of the term, Leo's mother asked Cynthia's mother, who was travelling with the kids, to make sure that he was injecting himself every night. Lionel was small and always went around here barefoot and played with the ball, says another neighbour, Ruben Menecavale. Many times we used to get mad at him, grab him and throw him to the ground, but he used to get up and carry on playing. A member of the Quiroga family, neighbours across the street, remembered that the kids didn't play all day with the ball, but he did. They all left and he carried on by himself by the gate. My mother scolded him many times because it was late and he carried on with the ball. When he played, sometimes, he would be hit, fall and cry, but he soon stopped and carried on running. You could see he was different. The skill he had, the speed, remembers Cynthia. It's said that Rodrigo was the first person to call him the Flea. In truth, no one in the neighbourhood gave him that name. The family believed that it was a Mexican football commentator who years later gave him the nickname. They're talking about Enrique Bermudez, considered one of the most prestigious voices in the Castilian language, a champion of pure entertainment, a narrator of what Jorge Valdano describes as the most important of the least important. The dog, Bermudez, that's how he's known, was a rocker, hippie, singer and film extra, before becoming a narrator and a creator of hundreds of nicknames. Adolfo Rios became Christ's Archer, Rafael Marquez, the Kaiser of Zamora, and David Beckham, Blue Shoes, because of the smurf-coloured boots he wore, and of the outlandish description of the footballing style of Barcelona's Pep Guardiola's, "Yours, mine, have it, lend it, caress it, kick it, give it to me." But Bermudez never claimed to be the creator of the nickname. Whoever it was still remains anonymous. In any case, it was clear that Leo had something special. He is a shining light sent by God. You know when someone says, "He will make it, he will." He was a footballer from the day he was born, says Claudia, Cynthia's mother, who sometimes babysat the young Leo. He played with a number 5 ball, so big that he could have hit it anywhere, and yet he controlled it perfectly, remembers his brother Matias. It was something beautiful. You had to see it, and whoever saw it for the first time would go back to see it. The ball, with a diameter that reached up to his knee, seemed stuck to his left foot, never too far away. Small touches that enabled him to keep control. Light strikes with the side of his boot. The ball always on the ground to avoid the possibility of a failure of technique that would cause the ball to bounce off his knee or his shin and run away from him to where the older boys could get it back. He had extraordinary coordination, a stature that helped him control the ball and natural speed. He challenged the older boys and he shone. Was this a divine gift or natural talent? There'll be time to discuss that later. What's more, his face redder than a tomato, he was a great competitor, or rather, very competitive. Or better still, he had a brave character and did not like losing. Behind the silences, there was a boy. He would often come home with a box full of marbles that he had won in the street. He counted them, and if there were ever any missing, he would go wild. Celia, his mother. When he was small, at home, he was very naughty. We used to play cards, and no one wanted to play with him, because we knew that sooner or later he would cheat. Jorge Messi. He did not want to lose at anything. Celia. If he didn't win, he would toss all the cards away. He did not want to go to school. He would say no. He did not want to go. Leo to El Grafico. Once, I had a fight with my cousin in his house. My grandmother was there as well. Everyone ended up against me. They threw me out and wouldn't let me in. So then I started throwing stones at the gate and kicking it. Celia. When I left him at the gate, he began throwing stones at me, saying he would not be coming back at midday. He would pepper the house with stones, and so I would go out and say to him, I'm going to tell your father. And he just scoffed at it. He was very spoilt. He had a very strong personality, which I guess he has got from the both of us, but a bit more from me. He is a person who says what he feels, both good and bad, because he doesn't try to hide his annoyance or his joy. From his father, he got his sense of responsibility, and he is very fair. That is what his parents were trying to convey in a documentary for Informe Robinson, fronted by the former Liverpool player Michael Robinson of Canal Plus, Spain. You cannot hide fierceness. If you have it, you have it, and sometimes, just occasionally, he would bare his teeth. The small pitch at Grandoli Football Club is surrounded by the Soviet-style concrete blocks of a dormitory town, a humble neighbourhood on the fringes of the city. Some say it is a hard and dangerous place. If you look closely between the buildings, you can see the boats that go downriver to the port of Rosario. The pitch is of earth, with strips of green along the sides, which mark the touch lines. The tall blocks seem like giants to the small players, who are indeed very small. Children of 5, 6, and 7 years old, and some older ones up to 12. A gate, a blend of turquoise and rust, flanks the entrance, while a fence around the pitch stops the balls. There's a sign that reads, Clean your boots here. The stand only has 3 rows of seats, and in the second row the parents of some of the children and grandmother Celia are seated. She has led little Leo by the hand to watch her grandson, Matthias. Rodrigo, who has also worn the red and white shirt of Grandoli, now plays for the juniors at Newell's. Leo is intermittently kicking a ball against the wall. The group is taken by Salvador Ricardo Aparicio, a thin, calm man who has spent 4 decades involved with formative football. On that day, there was one player missing, so the generation of 86 could play the usual 7-versus-7 game. It happens sometimes. Salvador waited to see if one more turned up. Put him on, says the grandmother, referring to the little 5-year-old, who in those days was not yet known as the flea. He's too small, woman. He could get hurt, answers Aparicio. Put him on, insists Celia. Okay, I will. But if you see that he is crying or he is scared, take him off. Open the gate and take him off. And so the coach puts him on, even though he is a year younger than the rest, at a time when such age differences are very noticeable. Out comes the little shrimp. The ball, when it comes to him for the first time, looks bigger than he does. And what happens next just had to happen. The usual thing. The ball comes to his right foot. Leo looks at it, and it goes way past him. The boy doesn't move. Aparicio raises his eyebrows. It's what he'd been expecting. Leo receives another pass. This time the ball comes to his left foot. To tell the truth, it hits him on the leg. But he takes 2 steps, accommodates the ball, brings it under control, and with little touches, he starts a diagonal run across this vast obstacle course, dribbling past anyone who gets in his way. Kick it, shouts Aparicio. Pass it, Leo. Grandmother smiles. Leo doesn't pass it. He's very small. But from then on, there was no way the coach was going to take him off. He played like he'd been doing it all his life, him against the other 13, Salvador remembered much later on. That year, he played the rest of the matches with the 1986 Grandoli side and won titles. Messi doesn't remember anything from that day. His grandmother told him he scored 2 goals. Leo wanted to play, of course, be it in the square, in the street, on his own, with his cousins and with Rodrigo and Matias. But, like any other kid, he wanted to do so with a kit, a team shirt, with a side like his brothers played in. And so at the age of 5, and after that day of surprises under the watchful eye of Celia, his smiling grandmother, in fact, even before his first day at primary school, he began playing every week in what is called baby football, 7-a-side for those aged between 5 and 12, at the Grandoli Club in the neighbourhood where he was born, located at number 4700 La Ferrera Street, an institution founded in February 1980 by a group of local fathers hoping to form a competition for children from the area. Take a look at this video. utu.be/OJ UNSUW6DH g. Leo is 5 years old. He is already demonstrating the same ease of dribbling and change of pace that he does today, the same joyous celebrations, the same diminutive stature compared to the others. El Piki gets the ball and looks for a gap, driving, dribbling. All his opponents follow him, so do his teammates. If he can't get in one way, he keeps the ball. He searches on the other flank, teammates and opponents all around him. You have to understand that in Argentina, it is considered vulgar to score. It is much better to create, assist, and link to leave your opponents in your wake. For that very reason, many thought that there was little about this extraordinary player that needed putting right. Rarely would the cry of, "Pass it, Leo," be heard again. At any given moment, the way would open up. Leo would launch the ball close to the post, far from the goalkeeper. Goal. There are those who like to say, probably to provoke you, that you need to see if Messi is capable of playing on a freezing Wednesday night in winter at, say, a rain-soaked Stoke. They need to look at the slopes, the stones, the small pieces of glass on the uneven football pitch on which he played for his first team, Grandoli's pitch, which is provided by the local authority and can only be used at night because by day it is used by a school. The lighting was also poor. From the age of 2, Lionel and his maternal grandmother Celia walked the 15 blocks that separate the Messi's house from his first club, Leo holding onto her arm as he struggled to keep up with her. Tucked under his arm was the ball he'd been given as a present. They were off to see Rodrigo and Matias, later just Matias. Finally, now in the team of boys a year older than him, he took the same route to training on Mondays, Wednesdays and Fridays. Games were played on Saturdays. She was too good. She lived for us, the grandchildren. She would put up with all our whims. The cousins used to fight to be allowed to sleep at her house. I don't know whether my grandmother understood football, but it was she who took us to play. She was my first fan at training at the games. Her cries of encouragement were always with me, Leo told El Mundo Deportivo in a rare moment of personal reflection. Celia did not watch football on television, nor would you find her at the Newell's Stadium. For her, football was where her grandchildren played. And for the grandchildren, life revolved around their grandmother, a definitive point of reference for this matriarchal unit of Italian origin, in which mutual respect and family support formed the cornerstone. If Leo is asked to define some of the best moments of his life, his illuminating answer will be, "The birth of each one of my nephews." That was asked, mind you, before the birth of his own son. Leo and his grandmother walked from home to Grandoli and back again, and when he started school, Grandma would collect him there at 5 o'clock in the afternoon. They would have a refreshing drink and then, along with Matias, go off to training. The fact is that it was a beautiful period in our lives. We really enjoyed Leo because, as a kid, he was already showing what he was made of. "My grandmother died later, but everything started with her," says Matias Messi. "Pass it to Lionel. Pass it to the little fella. He can score goals," she would shout. Grandma knew about football. And because of her roots, she had more Latin blood in her than the others. She was less able to control her emotions, showing her hand more often than not. Like every club in the world, Grandoli has its eternal rivals, opponents who go back to the beginning of time. Sometimes it seems even earlier. These are the games that they just cannot lose. Playing Alice was one of those. Hard, physical encounters that would sometimes end up with fathers exchanging words and the occasional slap. At one of these matches that got out of hand, Celia struck one of the Alice supporters over the head with a bottle. "Stop messing around," she screeched. No great harm was caused. That day, needless to say, Grandoli won. Shortly afterwards, it was discovered that Celia had Alzheimer's. The journalist, Tony Frieros reveals this in his early biography of Messi, Messi, el tesoro del Barça, Messi, the treasure of Barcelona. Celia gradually began to lose her memory, to have speech difficulties, and to confuse people, so for the last months of her life, the family watched helplessly as her vitality was slowly consumed by a degenerative and incurable disease. For Leo, it was like losing a part of himself. It was like watching a living death. Leo's grandmother died on the 4th of May, 1998, shortly before his 11th birthday. Celia never saw him play at the top or at Barcelona. For everyone, it was a huge loss, and all of us, without exception, felt such great pain. To this day, I still get emotional remembering Leo grabbing onto the coffin, weeping uncontrollably, recalls his aunt Marcella. It was a dreadful blow, says Leo now. Since then, when he celebrates every goal, Messi looks to the sky and points to the heavens. I think about her a lot, and I dedicate my goals to her. I would like her to be here, but she left before she could see me triumph. This is what makes me most angry, he confessed to El Mundo Deportivo in 2009. The poor woman, she never saw him triumph, but she was the catalyst, says Alberto Arellano, father of Cynthia and neighbour of the Messis. When he was forging his career, he always told me that at night he spoke to his grandmother and asked for her help, remembers Leo's mother. It's a shame that today she cannot see him. Who knows whether from up there or from wherever she may be, she can see what he has become and is happy for the grandson she loved so much. Leo believes in God, even though he is not a practicing Christian, like all the other Messis. But he owes gratitude to his grandmother for accompanying him in the formative years of his life, and because, surely, she is still with him. The only time he didn't raise his fingers first in salute to his grandmother after scoring was just after his son Tiago was born, when a thumb went into his mouth. But after that one instance, he would once again acknowledge Celia in the usual way. Leo left his neighbourhood for the first time at the age of 11. It was a Saturday in spring. He caught the bus with his friend Diego Vallejos, who is, incidentally, the brother of Matias's wife. He was from the same neighbourhood. The two youngsters made their way half an hour out of town to Via Gobernador Galvez in the south of the city to visit his grandmother's grave. Leo was at Grandoli from the age of 5 to almost 7. In that team of 87, he wore the number 10, and his cousin Emmanuel was the goalkeeper. Two things in particular kept repeating themselves during this period. They won practically everything that was going, and, well, Lionel always had the ball. Each practice, each game, was the most important ever. And before every practice, every game, and each one was the most important of all, Leo prepared in the minutest detail and without any assistance from anyone. First the boots, cleaned with water, then a cloth and a brush. Then the ankles were bandaged. He was like a professional, small and deadly serious. Salvador Aparicio was his first trainer, and in his sessions he made them jog, then asked them to loosen up a bit, and then introduced the ball. In those days, the entire enterprise consisted, really, of playing, playing and playing. Salvador, Don Appa, had a wonderful story. He was not the man who discovered him, rather the conduit for an unstoppable talent. The former railway worker who died of a brain fissure in 2009, aged 79, according to some people, you could hear the air escaping from his head, never presumed to be any more than that. I didn't discover him, but I was the first person to put him on the pitch. I am proud of that. Don Appa, like hundreds of anonymous trainers and technical directors, convinced dozens of children from the neighbourhood, aged between 4 and 12, to come off the streets for a while and spend time with Grandoli, where they would learn a certain order and happiness. His are the videos of Leo, small and going at full pelt in his red and white shirt, dribbling around defenders, getting the ball in his own box and taking it into the opposition's, scoring, then collecting the ball from the net to put it back on the centre spot to start all over again. He scored 6 or 7 goals every game. He positioned himself in the middle of the pitch and waited for the goalkeeper to kick the ball. The goalie kicked the ball. One of his teammates would stop it. He would then take it off him and set off on a dribble. It was something supernatural. This is how Don Appa, in various interviews, remembered Leo. When we went to a pitch, people would crowd in to see him. When he got the ball, he owned it. It was incredible. They couldn't stop him. Against Amanecer, He scored one of those goals like you see in the adverts. I remember it well. He dribbled past everybody, goalkeeper included. How did he play? Like he plays now, with freedom. He was a serious boy. He always put himself beside his grandmother. He was quiet. He never protested. If they whacked him, sometimes he would cry, but he would always pick himself up and carry on running. Every time I see him play, I start to cry. When I see the Maradona-type goal he scored, the one he got against Getafe, remember when he was little, so little? David Treves, who replaced Don Appa, is today president of Grandoli. He proudly displays the trophies won by the club and the team photos. Messi is the one wearing the shirt that is too big for him. It was very rare for a boy of his age to do all this, confirms Treves. It was said that we had the next Maradona. The best footballer in the world began here, and his first football shirt was ours. He would get the ball, and the move would finish with a goal. He made the difference even if they kicked him. This is how it is. If you're small and you play well, they break you. So recalls Gonzalo Diaz, who played with Leo during the time he was at Grandoli and naturally won everything. Matthias Messi finds it easy to put into words those days when he himself had dreams of becoming a footballer. And he, like all the Messis and all the other anonymous spectators, believed they were witnessing something special. Very often there were problems because of this, because he played so well. So well, in fact, that some coaches of the other boys sent their team out to bring him down. If they couldn't get the ball off him by fair means, they'd get it in other ways. It was something you had to see to believe. There were even players on the other team who would applaud some of his moves. What are you doing? The rival fans would ask. Sometimes it seems that many of those recollections reflect the Lionel Messi of today, rather than those of the little boy who played good football. Certainly a tireless scorer of goals, but at the time, a footballer of individual brilliance rather than a team player, and there is a big difference. They do not speak of a child, rather of a child who has become the greatest footballer in the world. It isn't the same thing. It is easy, with hindsight, to idolize those who succeed. And for this reason, it's difficult to find anybody who would dare to add a qualifying but. Anyway, at Grandoli, there were many others who showed promise. I have seen several who could have been like Messi, but they did not have the perseverance in training, says Gonzalo Diaz. Ah, perseverance. Without it, you cannot be a footballer. Jorge Messi also dreamed of becoming a footballer, but after 4 years at the NOB Academy, just as a player starts to blossom, when the first team beckons, Jorge left to do his military service, and on his return he married. When Jorge was 29, the age when most footballers reach their peak, Leo was born. Jorge has always had very fixed ideas, but he teaches by example rather than by word. His philosophy is simple. Work hard, be persistent, show humility, and you can achieve your goals. Maybe that is why Leo is not seduced by the celebrity culture, is not dazzled by those great names in neon lights. In any case, for Jorge, as with the overwhelming majority of the Argentine people of his generation, football was the inevitable and irresistible face of Maradona, videos of whom Jorge treasured and played frequently to his sons. Leo's father, therefore, passed down to his sons an appreciation of the one man who rose above the rest to lead his side, who caressed the ball as he was looking for the next pass, and who had the power in his feet to create a symphony of answers. For Lionel, and for many of his generation, that type of player could be seen in the shape of Pablo Aimar, the ex-River player. Lionel has said many times he did not have any football idols as a kid, but he liked to see Aimar. Is it true that he had no heroes? Don't we all have some point of reference? When he was asked at the age of 12 to name his idol, he said he had two, my father and my godfather Claudio. In that same interview, he confessed he considered humility the greatest of all virtues, something with which his father would agree. Leo, like his brothers, shared his father's passion for football. Jorge is a reserved man, even a little distant at times, and also a decent central midfielder, as little Leo would see when Dad played games with his workmates at the Asindar factory. He understood football, a game he loved. The Messis came down every weekend to Grandoli to watch Matthias and Lionel play, and one day a club director asked Jorge if he would take charge of the kids born in 1987. He thus became Leo's second coach. We were part of the Alfie League, one of the independent competitions that play in Rosario and the municipality. There were different categories up to 12 years old, and the youngsters always played on a seven-a-side pitch, Jorge told Tony Freiros. He trained three times a week with simple individual exercises, always with the ball to improve technique, and the occasional tactical exercise which the youngsters learned quickly, like little sponges, eager and delighted to soak up Jorge's instructions. Leo never did any specific work. He never spent his afternoons passing the ball with his right foot or dribbling around stones with his weaker leg. His father never asked him to. He simply played, and Jorge endeavoured to respect that free spirit in the weekly training sessions. It was 1994. Leo was 6 years old. Jorge Messi's side never lost a game in his only year as their trainer. We won the league and all the tournaments we entered, even the friendlies. Maybe it's a bit crude to say this, but the side caused a sensation because of the high standard it reached, and in that team, Leo shone out like a beacon, he has told the Argentinian press. In this team, and I don't want to overdo it, practically everything that is good he did. The goals, the dangerous situations, the one player who made the difference was him, the one who excelled was him. Okay, I'm his father, he is my son, and I'm not saying it for that reason, but because that's how it was, he told the magazine Kicker. The journalist interviewing him followed a line of questioning that might seem banal, but is nonetheless fascinating. Lionel, the footballer, who did he take more notice of, Jorge Messi, the trainer, or the father? Jorge answered, he was always very disciplined in his play, always obedient and did what was asked of him. He always took notice of what I said to him as a trainer. Even today he is like this, like when Frank Rijkaard at Barcelona put him on the right. He always complied with what the coach asked of him. He always played where he asked him to. It didn't matter who it was, and he never complained. That's how it always was. In life, there are three elements, mission, vision, and values, adds the prestigious Argentinian sports psychologist Liliana Grabin. The legacy you inherit from a father is the way he walks the path, the values he transmits. Leo carries with him the strong personality of his mother and the calmness, tolerance, and forbearance of his father. A strange combination. Yin-yang, I suppose. But he also passed on to him humility, self-sacrifice, and tenacity. But the son is also the result of his father's vision. Jorge once said that to hear your name being chanted is the greatest thing that can happen to a human being. If this is your dream, then you pass it on. Jorge had a vision. When he saw Leo play and understood that he had talent, his attitude was that of a proud father who wanted his son to stand out from his peers. A son always wants to please his father and will always try to continue pleasing him. The vision, the attitude, all marks the journey. Jorge lit the way. You can be a footballer. The family had the values. The vision is the future, and the mission is the playing of football. Jorge had vision. The family had vision. Obviously, he had a talent, and the mother and the father had the vision to continue the path that allowed him to explore and develop his talent, explains Grabin. Afterwards, Jorge, in his role as trainer, advisor, and even as manager, helped Leo negotiate the road. A dad and a manager, then. He gave him very little praise in comparison to the universal adulation he received. Rather, he gave him perspective. And, when necessary, he reminded him of the values that he considered ideals. At all times, he kept his son's feet firmly on the ground, particularly when it looked as though too much success might distract him and lead him to lose sight of the bigger picture, which would happen, as we shall see. Jorge, therefore, has from the start been father, guide, mirror, mentor, counterbalance, Leo's hero, the man he has to follow, occasionally rebel against, but the one who has to be recognised as his companion along the road, someone in whom Leo places absolute trust and unshakable faith. It was Jorge who decided that they had reached the end of the road with Grandoli. The whole family went to watch matches involving Matias and Leo, but on one occasion he was unable to pay the 2 pesos admission. He asked them if just this once they would waive the admission fee. They said no. Leo played that afternoon, but it was the last time he wore the Grandoli shirt. Teacher Monica Domina has her recollections. She had Leo in her class at Las Heras School between the ages of 6 and 8 in the 1st, 2nd, 3rd, and 4th grade, the first years of primary education. The thing is, he was a very quiet boy. Unfortunately, you always remember those who misbehave, those who bring you problems. But he was quiet, polite, and sometimes very introverted, with feelings that he did not want to show. He was a protected child, because with his classmates like Cynthia, they bonded together. They went into the same grade, and she was like his mother. She was twice as tall as him, because he was very, very small. He looked like a kid in kindergarten, and he had such a cheerful little face. The same as it is now. You feel like hugging him. And back then, even more so. Back then, the teacher was like a second mother. It isn't the same feelings that the teachers have nowadays. Yes, these young girls haven't got the same maternal instinct. We used to do it a different way. I would sit him on my knee, look after him, and now these things don't happen. And he was one of those who was like a baby, a little baby. You felt like picking him up and sitting him with you and chatting to him. He was very easygoing, but he hardly spoke at all. But one thing I do remember very well, I tried to get him to speak. I did this in the free time and during special lessons when we were doing stuff like drawing. That's when I had him close to me. But he wouldn't say anything, only yes, no. He wouldn't say anything else. But when I asked him questions about stuff in my field, like maths or comprehension, he would answer, and that set my mind at ease. Generally, Leo sat in the first row in the classroom, but he was very shy, and it was difficult for him to take part in class. He did his work, but didn't take his class by storm. He was doing well, doing what work he had to pass tests, and always handed work in on time. We, the teachers, tried to help him, and he did what he could. But it was not that he was incapable. No, it was that he didn't want to, because he had another interest. All he wanted was the ball. He was a normal boy, but not excellent. He was responsible. He did his work as well as he could. He did not study a lot. In the seventh grade, he got a good report. The head teacher let a newspaper take a photograph of the book in which the marks were recorded, and there you could see all of the marks. He was one of the best in PE, and did well in handiwork and music. In comprehension and mathematics, he did just enough. 7. That was a pass grade, so he was so-so. But my first image of him is playing with a football in the schoolyard, taking the ball from way back and dribbling with it. Even though they didn't always have a ball, sometimes they made one up with whatever they could, like socks that they had stuck together in a ball, or plastic bags, or even with silly putty. With whatever they could find, they played in the yard. But normally there was a ball. The PE teacher had a cupboard they would go to fetch it, or sometimes they would bring one from home. They knew if the PE teacher was there or not, and if he wasn't, some other teacher would look after the ball in between lessons. All those years ago, you would lend them a ball. Now you don't lend them one. Nowadays, they use the ball to hit their mate over the head. The number of students in those days didn't make any difference. There could be 100 of us, but we would all get on. They took care of each other. Therefore, the boys were allowed to play football. All his friends looked upon him as a kind of leader. They put him in the centre of the class photo. They all loved him, loved him. They waited for him. Let's go and play. They admired him because he shone. He would run from one side to another, and no one could catch him. He was a flea, a toy doll. He enjoyed himself and brought enjoyment to others. He never played pranks, but those eyes told you that here was a boy who did as he pleased. I think that the family... I always wanted to ask his mother what he was like at home because he behaved very well at school so as not to lose the chance of playing football. Because in the classroom he was very quiet, but when the bell went, he would run outside with everyone following behind him. You could see them all in the large multi-purpose room, with the two goals and all those youngsters desperate to play. Playtime was a football championship. Before, classes went like this. 40 minutes, a playtime of 15 minutes. 40 minutes, a playtime. But now, lessons last 1 hour and then a 15-minute break. They would play in that long break. That's when they would have time to play. They were like mini-matches. Maybe they would play the first half in the first break and the other half in the second break. So he would go out for that quarter of an hour along with the other boys, and he was like another person. And even if it was 7 against 7 or all against all, he would get the ball, and his game consisted of taking them all up and down the pitch. Because this wasn't about playing football. It was about dribbling. He was already practicing in, what do you call it? A small football school. And so many of the children that were with him were also in football schools. I always said that when his mother came with all his trophies and stopped at the classroom door, proud as any mother would be, he did not want his mother to come in. He didn't want to talk about what he had done. Or rather, from an early age, he didn't want to show that side of himself. He played because he liked playing. He had passion, just like now. He wasn't going to show that he was the best, because it was something he had inside. He always wanted to be treated just like any other boy. He did not want to stand out, and now he is exactly the same. An angel. But an angel as a person. I always meet his mother at the supermarket nearby, because his mother doesn't go around the city saying, "I am Messi's mother." She goes around like any other woman, modestly dressed, nothing vain, because I know the mothers of other footballers, and, well, some are full of, "I am the mother of." She is a lady, uncomplicated and good, and so is he. He doesn't go around telling people, "I have so many millions." No, he lives his simple life as simply as possible, I suppose, because that's how he was. Neither did he go around boasting about whether he scored a lot of goals or whether he hadn't, because there are many boys that would say, "Did you see that, miss? Me. But him, nothing of the sort. The family, the mother, that's how they showed him, and that's how they gave him the house rules, and that's why at school he was very quiet, very introverted. Little Leo did not have to walk far to his school at Las Heras. As soon as he hit the street with the ball glued to his feet, he headed for the wall that surrounded the army barracks and crossed the fields before coming out into Buenos Aires Street, just where it meets Juan Hernandez Square. The little school, painted white with touches of green, with its barred windows, occupies one side of the unkempt square with its trees and benches and paving slabs from which grass sprouts. It is one of those rare schools with well-behaved children, much like the neighbourhood itself, not like the usual Rosario schools with rowdy kids. Monica Domina would probably disagree. The most valuable thing is not the building, but the culture and ethos that radiate from it. When the child enters the school, he already knows about the level of behaviour expected, the values that he has to learn or maintain once there, the importance of belonging to the neighbourhood, of learning to improve, the need for collective effort. A genuinely good state school, then. The yard that leads to the classroom, with an arch framing the entrance and a tree in the centre, was so small it was barely big enough for keepy-uppy, or even to play with just one goal. For that reason, the boys preferred to resort to an area that today has many uses. There is a multi-purpose room where school assemblies take place, but at that time, when Leo was there, it did not exist. It was all just a small field, lots of space for kids to run around or for games to take place. So says Diana Toretto, who taught Leo when he was 6 years old, and who often stumbles over her words emotionally as she recalls the flea's time here. We would go into that small field with all the children, and something that I remember very well, and it makes me laugh even to this day, is that all of them run after the ball, and none of them manage to get it from him, and they would come up to me and moan, "Miss, he won't pass the ball. They couldn't take it off him." "He was a very happy boy," continues Miss Toretto. "Introverted, yes, but happy. He was always smiling, and he had a lot of friends. He was very popular with his peers, with a family that were always there for him, that always asked about what he was doing at school, because at home he was quite naughty, and his mother used to ask how he was here." There was, then, the Leo with the ball, the Leo at home, and the Leo at school. One Leo in the classroom and another one outside, free, in the schoolyard, competing. The conversation continues with Diana. Where does this need for his family, his school, and his peers to protect him come from? He generates that. This need to always keep an eye on him, look after him. That's why he has so many friends, I guess. His mates were very fond of him. When he was demonstrating the great skill he had with the ball, they admired him. Leadership qualities emanated from him. Not sure he knew about it, but the others saw that in him. A contradiction, because at the same time in the classroom he was quiet. But where he went, his mates followed him. He organised the game, and he took them to an activity that he loved, the playing of football. This is extraordinary, this leap from introversion to leadership. Yes, he was two different children. And if Leo had not been a Messi and had not made it as a professional, where would he be now? I think he would be with his family. Maybe he would have made his own family, as he now has, and of which we are very proud, and we hope that one day he will bring his son Tiago to see the school that he attended. That is what all of us teachers hope for. I think that, yes, he would be surrounded by all his family. I get emotional when I talk about him. 93. 6 years old. The year of the birth of Maria Sol. Bad at adapting to school environment. Hygiene practices. Effort shown. Manual expression. Music, writing, and physics. 94. Under the tutelage of Monica Domina. Bad at adapting to the school environment. creativity and effort shown. 95. 8 years old. Spectacular progress. Very good at mathematics. Very good at creative writing. Good at oral expression. Not a single bad report. Cynthia helped him a lot. An extension of himself, always together, says Domina. 10 in PE. Very good behaviour. Extract from Tony Frieros, Messi, El Tesoro del Barça. Leo was protected by both adults and children. Because he was small. Because he was good with the ball. Because he was a good kid. Because he was a son or a friend's son. For that cheeky smile. Because he was reserved, not shy, but introverted, guarded even. No one crossed him. No one gave him any aggravation. At least not at school. He had won them all over. It is easier to grow as a person, as a footballer even, with all that protection giving you a safety net. All children go through a testing time at school that has nothing to do with studying. The mob will bully them. It always happens. Childhood can be cruel. When it's your turn, make sure you come out of it well. Leo played well with a ball, and this drew people to him and helped him to be respected, loved, needed, and protected. He was small and conscious of his size, but the rest of the playground ignored this difference because he never failed to impress those who played alongside him, those who watched him as he played. So he was never bullied. There were fights to be on his team because with him on your side, you were sure to win, and better to win rather than lose the yard games, because the defeats had to be put up with for the rest of the day. Even when there were boys missing in the older grades teams, they would invite him to play for them so that he could help them become champions. And Leo obliged, leading with his silence and his game, just as now, more by his actions than by his words. But it couldn't all be football. The teachers could not allow that passion for the ball, for the playground match, to take over the pupils' lives to the point where it was impossible to make them understand that playtime had ended. The teachers' challenge with Leo was to disengage him from the game, and distancing him from the ball, from this invisible but oh-so-tangible connection, was a daily struggle. Today, the teachers cite Messi as an example of... The question is directed at Cristina Castañera, the new head teacher at Las Heras School, who did not know Leo and who views the phenomenon that was Leo's presence from a certain distance and with some surprise. I don't know. Just about everyone who comes to the school knows about Leo. They all know he used to be here. I don't know if it's explicit, but it's here all the time. Now I'm in charge, I'm going to see if we can create a messy corner with all the cuttings. There's nothing anywhere. Is that good for the students, to create his own special corner? I don't know, but so many things get done in his name. So you feel that something should be done that can serve as an example, a motivation? What do I know? We have... The Argentine culture allows these situations of... We are very much of... Legend? Myth? Yes, of course. The success of Messi is not going to be on the curriculum, but it would be good to have something so that when people come from outside, we could always be ready to show them things. Or to him, if one day he comes back here, because he has been to the school before. I have been in this profession for 30 years, and I always follow school procedure. This seems like I'm departing from procedure, but anyway, it doesn't matter. You don't have to be that strict. I don't think they'll applaud me for it, but that isn't the idea. The idea is that there should be a messy corner that will serve as a reminder of him. Leo, the public Leo, represents a series of commendable values. Of course, above all, because he is a person of whom one can be proud. Messi has those values inside him that one would like to instill in others. An Argentinian friend of mine, a footballer, told me that the government should get hold of Messi once a month and get him to say, brush your teeth, and then suddenly all the country would brush them, or behave yourselves at school, and then suddenly the whole country would change. I don't know if it would come to that. Yes, it could. When Leo's grandmother took him for training with Grandoli after school, they would have crossed the fields of the old quarter that will probably in the future become, who knows, some kind of business park, or maybe, now that the council has loaned the land to the Messi family, pitches created so as to train young footballers who share Leo's dreams. If there was no training, he would meet up to play with friends from the neighbourhood, friends like Diego Vallejos. We often did things together. There was always some new trick to learn, something to try or something to do. We weren't really mischievous. Sometimes we would wreck flower beds with a ball or use gates as goals. We played with an air pistol. We did a lot of things. Coming out of his house, on the left-hand side, about 200 metres down, there is an open space. This was the Camp Nou of Argentina. This is where he took his first steps in football, where we used to have our kickabouts, where we ran, where we hid. It was our place. At Fragotti's, a nearby store, Leo would use the iron door to do 1-2s to prevent his friends stealing the ball from him. It was an age when neither time nor clearly marked out lines existed, and few limitations were put on them other than those set by their school or parents. We cut the wire fences that surrounded the old quarter to be able to play, and time again were chased out by some of the military people because we weren't supposed to be there, recalls another neighbour, Walter Barrera. But the thing was that this field was perfect for us to play football because it had a wonderful grass surface that no one ever walked on and was great to play on. Sometimes they took us by surprise while we were playing and took us indoors where they had a type of cell, but nothing happened. They would take you in through one door and then let you out through another. More than anything, it was just to scare us. Leo spent his primary school years in Las Heras before starting his secondary education at the age of 13 at Juan Mantovani Middle School on the Avenida Uruburu, also close to home, only to leave it just 4 months later. In his mind, his future was away from all that he knew. At Juan Mantovani, he did not have his inseparable soulmate, Cynthia, at his side. Some of the things closest to him were beginning to change. Leo is the benefactor not of that school, but of his first one at Las Heras. Over the past decade, he has donated the equivalent of 2 years of the total school budget, and he visited the school in 2005. One of the teachers had a son who had played football with him and made the most of that contact by inviting him along for the school's anniversary. They were putting on an event, and Leo turned up. He wasn't as well known then as he is now, but he still made their day. And one afternoon, 2 years later, towards the evening, he returned again, this time to see his cousin, Bruno Biancucci. It was a surprise visit, and he arrived with his head down, quiet, hiding behind Bruno's mother, his Aunt Marcella. He was dying of embarrassment. Suddenly, something switched on in his head. He began to connect with the other children, to talk to them. He went around all the classrooms, kissing people, signing autographs, and allowing himself to be photographed. 3 memorable hours for both students and parents in a school where, except perhaps for the playground breaks, hardly anything ever seems to happen. A boy from the first year, no more than 5 years old, said to a friend of more or less the same age and size, wearing the same little shorts and with the same little school smock, "Pinch me." Chapter 2. Waiting for Leo. A true story, with scenes and imaginary meetings set in 2 acts. We hear from Leo's teammates, coaches and technical directors during his years at Newell's, some of his opponents, neighbours and others who have played a part in his life. They speak with a touching devotion, but also of time tinged with melancholy. This is what can happen when genius touches your life. There are plenty of names, and they all have huge relevance. This is, after all, their story as well as Leo's. But allow your imagination to be suspended while you read this. You don't have to remember who is who or who says what. In a way, they all symbolise a single character who represents all those that accompanied him in Rosario. So, if you get lost in the maelstrom of names, just latch onto the hand of the kid who couldn't grow. The action takes place in Rosario, in the late 90s, the last years of a forward-looking Argentina. The first act is set in a cafeteria at Malvinas, the training centre for youth teams of Newell's. Act 1. Scene 1. Voices can be heard off. The set is lit by a single light. Where's Leo? He's got hepatitis, so they say. Ah. The scene goes dark, and the words 6 years earlier appear. On the wall of the set, the following video is projected. http://www.youtube.com/watch?v=9 GF/EI/JEG/J/U/O. It shows a 5-year-old Messi who collects the ball and controls it. He doesn't pass it, but searches out the route to goal. He dribbles past opponents, moving from side to side until he can hit an accurate shot away from the goalkeeper. And he scores. He turns and runs back into his own half with a minimum of gestures, taking little steps, waiting for the game to restart. Later, his side kicks off and the first touch is to Messi, who heads for goal, dribbling once again past whoever crosses his path. The ball is almost as high as his knees. It is a game played at the Malvinas, a name with particular connotations, and where the Newell's old boys youngsters play seven-a-side, also called baby football. The simple sports centre is divided into two parts by Vera Mojiga Avenue, and the best cared for pitch is pitch number one. It has a stand and hosts most of the games, such as the one in the video. Walking from Leo's home was impossible. It was too far, so someone always had to bring him. His father, mother, the father of a teammate perhaps. And often he would arrive in a white Renault 12 that belonged to the father of his friend Agustin, a car that would be driven down Uriburu Avenue until it reached Boulevard Orono, and then up, crossing Independence Park, where the Newell Stadium was located, up to Pellegrini Avenue. You had to turn left before arriving at Francia, and two blocks further you turned left again by Zaballos Street. The main gate was at number 3185. Inside is a mural with all the names of the players who have made it into the first team. Leo's name isn't there yet. Between the entrance and the goal of pitch one, there are two small buildings. The cafe, with tables and chairs, and the office area. There's always something going on around here. Fathers sitting around with coffee or beer talking football. Their sons kitted out in their NOB shirts. People going in and out. Older men who used to be at the club and who now come by to see what's happening. Friends of the fathers. In the Malvinas cafeteria, while keeping an eye on the children as they play on the adjacent field, a group of friends chat as they sit at round tables with a beer or a coffee. It is mid-afternoon. Some time ago, someone removed the Malvinas sign that hung in the entrance, and now we see it in a corner, abandoned, its corner rusting. Painted on the wall at the back of the set, a building of two floors. The ground floor has a door that leads to offices with random paper strewn about, the odd trophy on the floor and others on a shelf. On the second floor, there is a door which, strangely, leads nowhere. Nobody can explain this. Maybe the money ran out and there wasn't enough left to put in a staircase. Hardly anyone goes up to the second floor. The club's office is on the first one. On the edge of the set, between the actors and the audience, are some goal nets. Gabriel Di Girolamo, coach, NOB. The day they brought him to me, I said, "Well, this is something totally different from what one would expect, no?" Ernesto Vecchio, coach, NOB. He had a spectacular technique. No one taught him that. He was born with it. Gabriel Di Girolamo. You never expected that something so diminutive could make such an explosive impact. He was someone who thought about what he was going to do and then did it. He went from right to left, from left to right, through the centre, moving deep, and always with a goal in his mind, always there inside his head. Ernesto Vecchio. Before he even got to Newell's, the whole of Rosario was talking about the talent of a young boy who played for Abanderado Grandoli. Diego Rovira, number 9 with the juniors at NOB. I had arrived at Newell's halfway through 1998. My first training session was at the Bella Vista site, where the first team train. We played a friendly against Renato Cesarini. We won 7-0, something like that. Three of the goals were scored by a tiny, extremely quick and skillful little fella. I didn't know anyone, but he was the first to catch my attention. It was Leo. Rosario was getting to know Leo because he was starring in the interschool tournaments, like the popular Alfie League. Here, you could meet technical directors, scouts, trainers with eyes sharpened by years of watching coaching sessions and baby football matches. Rodrigo and Matias were in the junior ranks of NOB, and it was Rodrigo who suggested that Leo was ready to play for Newell's in preliminary tournaments at the start of the Rosario season. So at the beginning of 1994, at the age of 6 years and 7 months, he played for a few weeks with a number of the Newell's youth teams, afternoon and evening. Roberto Menzi, director of NOB. At the time of picking a player, primarily what you have in mind are his technical qualities, then his physical attributes, and finally, you take a look at the home life of the boy. Quique Dominguez, coach, NOB. At Newell's, there was a philosophy driven by Jorge Bernardo Grifa, a former player with Atletico de Madrid. Newell's has to have the best players. We cannot allow ourselves the luxury of losing a great talent. So I would take my car and stop and wait 5 minutes watching a kid's game, and if there was something that grabbed my attention, I would get out of the car, get to the side of the pitch and ask, "Are you the mother?" "Yes." "Has your boy signed for any club?" And if he had, I would say, "Wouldn't he like to play for Newell's?" We would steal them before they could be stolen from us. By way of natural selection, really, Leo always played alongside the best players in the area. Gabriel Di Girolamo. Claudio Vivas came to see me, the one who was assistant to Marcelo Bielsa, and said, "You're going to have a boy here who is out of this world." He played 3 or 4 games with my team and with other coaches at the club, like Walter Lucero, a few others. Quique Dominguez. When it came to comparing Leo with his rivals, in terms of quality, the gap was vast, and I mean vast. Up against a defender, 8 out of 10 times, Leo would do exactly what he wanted. The defender got it right and almost recovered the ball once and lost possession on the other occasion. The difference was enormous. Today, Leo seems to still be a superior player compared to the rest, but the rest are now players from Real Madrid, from Serie A in Italy, from the Premiership in England. Gabriel Di Girolamo. At the end of the preliminary tournament, we asked Leo if he wanted to play for us. Ernesto Vecchio. After watching him play, we spoke to the parents and reached an agreement. He joined Newell's. All the Messi's are Newell's fans. Except for Matias, as we know, he supports Rosario Central. And so it was that on the 21st of March 1994, just shy of his 7th birthday, he was signed up by the club he supported. A Leo who measured 1 meter 22 centimeters in height, that's just over 4 feet, arrived at Newell's, where, 3 months earlier, Diego Armando Maradona, who was preparing himself for the 1994 World Cup, had played his last game during his brief stay with the Rosario club. Jorge Valdano, ex-NOB player. Newell's has a very good football school in a city that clearly has an overwhelming connection with football, being in an area that is just one huge football pitch. Quique Dominguez. I encouraged them to do what they did best and then subtly polished it. That's how I made my reputation in the schooling of football. I never shouted or threatened or scolded or humiliated or applied pressure, as my father did with my brothers and me. So, if you make a big cock-up, I want you to understand what you've done and not to repeat it, not because you're frightened, but because you understand what you did wrong. Gerardo Grigini, ex-junior player with NOB. We had all 7 and 8-year-olds, and we played on the 7-a-side pitch and did the usual kids' training. A bit of speed work, keepy-uppy and technique. But at that time, the most important thing was to learn to play the ball with your feet, to domesticate the ball. We trained Tuesday, Thursday and Friday, and played Saturday and Sunday. Quique Dominguez. Yes, we did the typical training sessions about passing and stopping the ball. Once, one of the coaches asked his pupils how many ways of touching the ball a player had, and they answered, 10, 15, 12. Well, there are in fact almost 200. You can even stop it with your back. So, now then, how many ways are there of passing the ball? You see, what we were trying to do at the football school is teach the kids all these things. How to pass the ball, how to stop it, how to imagine the play. To be aware that to reach the goal, it is not always the best idea to look for a long pass. Gerardo Grigini. We had fun, above all, because we were a group of friends. We were not at school or at work, where nobody spoke to each other. No way. We were a group of mates. In fact, I couldn't wait to get out of school, get something to eat, and then go to training. Quique Dominguez. We also showed them situations that could occur in a game, and sometimes we encouraged competition. We showed them what we call here loco, crazy, and what is known at Barcelona as rondo, piggy in the middle, although there were always arguments because no one wanted to go in the middle. Somehow, we created an environment that encouraged craftiness, even though it has to be said the Argentinians have sometimes gone too far down that road, as was demonstrated by Maradona's handball goal. But in those games, in practice, you needed cunning. There are 6 categories at the Malvinas for kids aged 6 to 12, and even though now they still have some 300 children, it is said that there have been occasions when there were 800 under the control of Newell's. From these earth pitches, now grass on the pitch 1, have come Bielsa, Cencini, Balbo, Batistuta, Valdano, Pochettino, Solari. and this is just one of the schools scattered throughout Argentina. Thousands of youngsters sign up for them, the assured route to the top. But normally, after just a couple of years, here too is where, for many of them, their footballing dreams come to an end. Jorge Valdano. I left my home and found myself on a football pitch that measured 1,000 square kilometres. A vast plain, interrupted only by the odd cow or an occasional tree, with everything else a football pitch. And a well-fed area, which is also important because there are other more deprived areas where the problem of nutrition does not favour the rise of great footballers. There is passion, sentiment, hope and frustration in Rosario, and you learn about football. But above all, you gain friends, you understand the meaning of community, and you create narratives for your life that will be with you forever. Argentina creates its social image around the ball. They play for their lives, and even if ultimately that isn't true, that's the feeling you're left with. It is a place to win and to learn how to win, and that attitude helps kids improve. Football at this age is pure, old, real and unrepeatable, even though market forces are threatening it, even though some of the legendary technical directors, such as Grifa, did not make footballers to sell, but rather to grow as more rounded individuals. Quique Dominguez. The way of competing is also very important, because it is no fun having four goals stuck past you. It's obviously much more fun to score them. But above all, you have to show that at the end of the game, it is just a game. The kids have to shake hands, congratulate the winners, even if you have lost 10-0. Or if you have won, you have to congratulate the losing side. And if they don't want to shake hands, no problem. We turn round and go home. Sometimes it will be us who will not feel like doing it. Jorge Valdano. Jorge Grifa was the guru of football development in Argentina, and Newell's followed his ideas, which placed their academy at the top of the scale. Quique Dominguez. And from Newell's, Leo took technique, craft, and his winning attitude. What I always said to my lads was, we go onto the field, we are winning 1-0, we look for the 2-0, we look for the 3-0, 4-0, and so on, unless the ref decides to stop the game. There was a time here when we won 10-0, 15-0, and of course the matches used to get to a point when the boys from the other side, maybe after the 10th goal, did not want to play anymore. Then they put a limit of 6-0. At 6-0, the game would be halted. Jorge Valdano. But in a way, it all ended when Grifa packed up. In recent years, some terrible abuse has taken place. For example, the Barras Bravas, football's ultra-supporters, were the owners of the youth players. This alone tells you about the moral bankruptcy that overtook the club, something that has thankfully been remedied under new management. Ernesto Vecchio. It's possible that the standard of baby football has gone down a bit, but this is because of the change in society. There are boys whose fathers can't bring them because they are unable to pay. That's it. Also, the children of today are different. They are more rebellious, answer back, don't listen. Before, they were more manageable. Now they are more difficult. Another thing that has an effect is that there are not so many new fields available. We lack pitches. Today, technology affects children who prefer to be with a computer, PlayStation, the internet, and they are not so interested in doing sport, unfortunately. Scene 2. Onto the darkened set, a video is projected where you can see the 8-year-old Messi scores with both feet. He hardly gives the ball to anyone, shows his competitive spirit when they hit him. When he is knocked over, he stops at first and then carries on. Even in this, he isn't like the rest. And then, in the 5th minute, comes a typically Rosarian moment. Messi and the rest of the side who have just won the game receive instructions from their coach to go and console their beaten opponents. Leo runs to a young rival lying on the ground, rueing his team's defeat. Of course, he is doing what he has been told by the coach, but nobody ordered him to run to the player, nor to get down on his knees, nor embrace the rival lying on the floor. At this age, there is no hypocrisy. None of this can be forced. Many would call this football in its purest state. The characters look over the newspaper, Olé. One of them starts to read in a loud voice. Lionel Messi is quite sure in his own mind that his future does not lie as a coach. He cannot see himself giving instructions from the bench. However, when he starts to talk about football, his references all finish at the same place, always stressing the main traits. A side that always attacks, a high defensive line, a great deal of pressure high up the pitch to force the opposition to play long, and goals, lots of goals. Pep's Barcelona? No. The machine of 87, an unbeatable side that joined the ranks of Newell's Infantiles. Leguizamón, Peche, Gian Antonio, Casanova, Scalia, González, Jiménez, Ruani, Macha, Bravo, Miro, among others. Gerardo Grigini. I think the name Machine of 87 came much later. I don't remember anyone calling us that. Diego Rovira. Newell's side of 87. Quique's side. Quique Dominguez, the father of Siba, the one who plays at Vélez, the central defender. In goal was Juan Cruz Leguizamón, who is now at Central Córdoba. At number five played Lucas Scalia, a monster. They called him Pulpo, the octopus. These days he is at Juan Caldas in Colombia. Rosso is today at Brescia. Grigini, you have played in Italy. Leandro Jiménez, who afterwards went to River, and another Leandro, Benitez, and Leo, Roncalia, and me. The Newell's 87 side was invincible, people used to say. We won everything in 1999 and nearly everything in 2000. This is how the games went. 8-0, 7-2. We lost count. Gerardo Grigini. In Rosario, they talked a lot about this group because we had Leo, Juan Cruz, Leguizamón, Lucas, Scalia. They were very good players. We started on small pitches, seven aside. Leo on his own would score three or four. Diego Rovira. That forward line was tremendous. Leo, number 10. At seven, Roncalia. Yes, Roncalia. Very fast, hitting some great crosses, I remember. Adder Bergesio. What a guy. What a player, Bergesio. And up front with the number 9, me. The same person as before, it could be anyone, begins to recite again in a loud voice another paragraph from the Olé article. The team functioned with the collective solidarity of a colony of worker ants. That's how they maximised their potential. And Leo, at just 8 years of age, was already the distinctive feature, the driving force of a well-oiled machine. Diego Rovira. In 1999, we played three tournaments and won them all. I even remember winning all the matches, too, like 45 of them. 15 per tournament. Madness. All of them. Well, except for one against Central. They were the only side that could give us a game, although in the return we walloped them 4-0. They never got close to our goal that day. It was rare that any side got close to our goal. Quique Dominguez. From Argentina, Leo took the natural technique of the Latin American, like Neymar, like Ronaldinho, Riquelme. The way to position the body to accommodate the ball, to control it, to direct it. From Newell's, he took the winning mentality. Leandro Benitez, ex-junior player at NOB. He was a sensation. We'd arrive at the pitch and our opponents would say, I wouldn't give you 2 pesos for him, but when he got the ball, he skinned them. Diego Rovira. One time, it occurred to one of Quique's assistants that it would be a good idea to compete against each other to motivate us. The Newell's of the first half against the Newell's of the second. At half-time, we were winning 3-0. Perfect. And in the second half? 4? So when the Newell second team won 4-3, it was a laugh. With Leo playing, football was a laugh. Ernesto Vecchio. He was a marvel. He was clever. He had a good short touch. He would leave the ball dead. He played for his teammates. Once, on pitch one at the Malvinas, the goalkeeper gave him the ball, and he went from one goal to another to score a stupendous goal. You didn't have to show him anything. What can you show a Maradona or a Pele? The only thing that a coach could do is correct some little details. Juan Cruz Leguizamón, ex-junior player at NOB. In Europe, he became famous for that goal he scored against Getafe. But for us, that was normal. We saw him score goals like that as a matter of course. Diego Rovira. Leo. Every time I see him, I smile, thinking about the crazy things that he does. He's a monster. Like the 5 goals he scored against Bayer Leverkusen. Who else would think of scoring 5 in a match, let alone in the Champions League? And just how does he do it? That's exactly how it was at Newell's. Less acceleration, less explosion, but the same. Quique Dominguez. He had fantastic coordination for someone of his age. For Leo, it's like the ball forms part of his body. If it comes high and he has to use his head to control it, he uses his cheek because he knows that is the best way to cushion it. Perhaps another boy will put his forehead first because he knows it's a harder part of his body and more used to taking a hit. Why? Because Leo is different. Gabriel Di Girolamo. Technically, he was gifted like no boy I have ever seen. He was so good that a lot of times I changed his position so he could adapt to all aspects of playing on the pitch. On one occasion, I played him as sweeper, and yes, it looked like he had been playing there all his life. Quique Dominguez. I often say that I don't know who learned more from whom, Leo from us or us from Leo. Adrian Correa, coach NOB. You don't coach your team when Leo's playing, they used to tell me. Diego Rivera. Leo would take on a couple of players and left me one-on-one. It was always like that. I had to get myself prepared, stopped on the last line of our opponents, ready. One-on-one, guaranteed. The other trick we did was the long ball if things got complicated, which they rarely did. Leguizamo, the goalkeeper, would look for me. Bring it down for me, Leo would shout. Can you imagine? I was a head taller than my rivals. Easy. Juan Cruz Leguizamo. At one of the tournaments, if we became champions, the organizers were going to give us each a bicycle. We got to the final, but we started the match without Leo. He just didn't arrive. And we finished the first half 1-0 down. Where was he? He got there late because he'd been locked in the bathroom at home and had to break the glass in the window to get out. He got in there in time for the second half, and we ended up winning 3-1, with three goals from Leo. But, like I said, millions of games. There were many things we lived together, a whole childhood. Bruno Milanesio, ex-junior player at NOB. I remember telling my grandmother, who saw me crestfallen, that Leo had sprained his ankle and wouldn't be able to play the following day. My grandma is a healer, and she asked me the name of the boy. Leo Messi, I told her. She never told me what she had done, nor did I want to tell Leo that my grandmother had, well, that she'd healed him. But the following day, Leo got up as if nothing had happened, with the swelling on the ankle gone. He played, and we came out champions. Years later, I was at my grandmother's house, and on television there was Messi playing for Barcelona. Grandma, do you remember him? I asked her. When she answered, not in the slightest, I reminded her. Now, when she sees Messi on television, she smiles and boasts. That boy, I healed that boy once. Gerardo Grigini. At that time, we did not have to work for the team. Not much, anyway. It was simple. We just needed to give him the ball, and that was it. Game over. He might lose it once or twice, but the third and fourth time, he'd score two goals, guaranteed. Angel Ruani, father of ex-NOB player Luli Ruani. Many people nowadays don't believe it, but Leo scored about 100 goals per season in all the games we played. If we bear in mind that he came to Newell's in 1994 and left in 2000, we're talking about more than 500 goals throughout his time with the Infantiles, which is totally outrageous. Adrian Correa. Perhaps he was not aware of it at the time, but in a way it is an advantage to be small. You control the ball better, you're more agile and faster than the rest. Quique Dominguez. He passed the ball, but wouldn't just push it to you, but rather lift it up. Bounce it up on his toes a couple of times before passing, that kind of thing. Leo is football in its purest sense. Not obsessed with the money, no. Football for the fun of it. Gerardo Grigini. On the Newell's pitch, the directors would ask him to do some keepy-uppy before the game or at half-time. On one occasion, in Mar del Plata, he did keepy-uppies before the game and fans would throw money at him, coins. 15 minutes would go by and he still hadn't lost control of the ball. In Peru, I think he got up to 1,200 touches. He was 9 years old at the time. Franco Casanova, ex-junior player at NOB. At the farewell of the legendary Newell's player and current Barcelona manager, Gerardo Martino, in the summer of 1996, the Newell's boys did a lap of honour at half-time. They had been crowned champions. Suddenly, they stopped in the middle of the pitch and pushed Leo into the centre circle. The stands raised the roof. Marado! Marado! Screamed the crowd as Leo practiced his keepy-uppies. Nestor Rotzin, former director of NOB. For every 100 touches, sometimes he got an ice cream, and I think he made 1,100 touches, and they gave him 10 ice creams. Gerardo Grigini. At 11, we went from 7-a-side to 11-a-side, sometimes both, Saturday the 7s and Sunday's 11s, to get used to it. And against 11, he stood out even more. He had more pitch, more space. He was fast, very fast. He got through gaps he didn't fit into. It was incredible. Adrian Coria. I played him just behind the strikers, either in a free roll or, as it is known, enganche, in a 4-3-1-2 formation. Quique Dominguez. His opponents tried to hide the effect he had on them, but would eye him up and down with a bit of fear. He generated something inexplicable for a kid of 10 or 11 years old. Diego Rivera. The conversations between the opposing defenders were wonderful. We can't stop this kid. No. So what are we going to do? How should I know? Didn't you just say that he can't be stopped? They were right. Once at a training session, one of the coaches played me at the back. Mama, they made me play at the back, and on top of that, I had to mark Leo. You should have heard me that night. Mum, I couldn't even grab him by the shirt, and I wasn't about to start kicking Leo. My poor mother, she remembers it to this day. Enough, Leo! Stop fucking about! Stop running! I kept saying to him while he was pissing himself with laughter. He's fun, is Leo. Funny. Quique Dominguez. We were playing against Morning Star, and their trainer came up to me and asked me if I would take Lionel off at half-time, and of course I said no, because Leo and the goalkeeper, Leguissimo, I never took off. Gerardo Grigini. Once, he performed 5 flickovers against one player. The player threw himself to the ground and grabbed his feet. 5 flickovers, one after the other. On top of that, he was 1.4 meters, while the other boy was 1.7. That's how he enjoyed himself. He didn't do it to brag. No, no, no. There was never any lip. None of that. Never. In the Rosario League, Oriental, Rio Negro, they are teams from the neighborhood that like to play it rough, dish it out, and no, they bitched at him, said things to him, and he said nothing. He just showed everything with his football. Quique Dominguez. I have seen games in the lower levels of Argentinian football that are pitched battles. It is okay if you dribble past me, but next time I'll have you. I'll get sent off, but you won't be doing that to me again. That happens a lot here, and that's what they would have done to Leo had he stayed here any longer. One of the few instructions that I gave him was to release the ball quickly, because when he had control of the ball, defenders did all kinds to stop him. And the kids, sometimes from instructions given to them by their elders, or sometimes off their own backs, if they couldn't stop him and he went past you, then past you, then past you again, they would elbow him, kick him from behind. So I told him, make sure you get rid of the ball earlier. But for him, the way he played, which is the way you see now, keeping the ball was only natural. And by the way, he had a very good eye to see when they were coming in to hit him, so often they couldn't even come close. Adrian Coria. On the contrary, that rough treatment lit a spark in him. The more they went for him, the more he fronted them up. Angel Ruani. On one occasion, on the Adur pitch, we, the parents, were really angry, and we asked Gabriel, the coach, to take him off, because they would not stop kicking him. On another game, at the home of Vélez Sarsfield, they put in a very hard tackle. He fell awkwardly and injured his arm. His mother and my wife took him to hospital. Quique Dominguez. For Leo, the ones who protected him were the referees. Because he didn't kick anybody, didn't protest or grab players' shirts or taunt his opponents. So when they bombarded him, he generated a need to protect him. He was tiny, with a tiny face, mischievous with a smile, and 100% skillful, but with a tremendous work ethic. He was the player who ran the most. Gerardo Grigini. Leo was also very strong. Lots of people would throw themselves at him to try to bring him down, but he was strong. He took it. He fell, he got up, he fell again, and he got up again. Incredible. If any of us fell, we stayed down and probably started to complain. But not him. He fell and still carried on with the ball. I don't know where that comes from. One in a million must come out like that. Quique Dominguez. He never complained, despite the fact that, while the other boys were waiting to be handed their shirts, Leo was the only one who would turn away to remove his shirt, away from everybody's sight, and put on the red and black number 10. I thought it was because he was embarrassed. The time I did see him, I was stunned. He barely had a ribcage. It was caved in. Looking at his chest was scary. One time he fell and broke and dislocated his wrist. Bone problems. He was very fragile. But I never saw him wince or make any show of pain. He didn't play the following games in a competition we used to call the Mini World Cup. But on the first day of the tournament, we saw he was carrying a small bag. Intrigued to find out what he had in it, I asked one of the mothers of the other players. She said he had brought his boots and his shin pads with him. So he could play, and he still had 15 days to go with his plaster cast. He said, "I know if Kike needs me, he'll put me on." No way. And then one day, during that competition, I asked him as a bit of a joke if he felt like playing in the second half, plaster still on, and he said, "Yes, but no way would I play him like that." He was a fragile little boy from the outside, but inside he was very strong. Leo Messi once said, "The last time I felt pressure was as a footballer with NOB when I was 8 years old. From then, I come on to enjoy myself." He was at that time 23 and had played in 2 Champions League finals, 2 World Cups and Cup finals. Never mind those. He left behind the real pressure on a pitch in Rosario. Gazzo, journalist. Rosario Central and Newell's were playing in the final of the tournament named after my radio programme, Baby Gol. The game finished 2-2, and in the penalties that followed, the kids got to a score of 22-22. At this point, the Rosario Central player took his kick and missed. Everything rested on Leo's feet. If he scored, the tournament would be Newell's. Kike Dominguez. Once they asked me what was the greatest characteristic that I saw in Leo, and I said his naturalness. Everything, from the moment he greets you, even though he seems reserved, is natural. At 12, he would finish a game and used to go to the house of his friend, Antonella's cousin, Lucas, and there he would stay for the weekend. Sometimes, on Thursdays, after training, he would go to Lucas's house. For a while, he used to spend most of his free time at Lucas's. Needless to say, his now wife didn't give him the time of day. Now, he is living with and has a son with the woman he has loved all his life. He did not need to put on a lavish wedding.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.